Welcome everyone to the fourth meeting in 2017 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everyone present please to ensure that their mobile phones are on silent for the duration of the meeting. No apologies have been received, and so we're going to move straight on to agenda item one, decision on taking business in private. At agenda item one, the committee is asked to decide whether to take item five in private. This is to consider the committee's approach to looking at the impact of the UK's departure from the EU on policy areas within its remit. Are all members agreed?
Yes.
Agreed. Item two. The second item on the agenda is the evidence session for the Minister of Transport and the Islands on rail services in Scotland. This session was originally scheduled for the 18th of January, but has to be postponed. It forms part of a series of regular updates to the committee, allowing it to monitor rail network and rail service and performance issues. Can I ask any members, before we go any further, whether there are any interests to declare? Gail.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I have an interest which is on my register. I am an Honorary Vice President of Friends of the Far North Line.
Okay. Ryan. Thank you.
I'm Honorary President of the Scottish Association for Public Transport and Honorary Vice President, Rail Future UK.
Okay. Thank you. I welcome the Minister for the Transport and Island, Hamza Youssef. I'd also like to welcome Bill Reavy, the Director of Rail at Transport Scotland, and Gary Bogan, Head of the Franchise Management Unit at the Scottish Government. We've got a huge amount covered this morning, and I'd appreciate if members could keep their questions as short as possible, and witnesses in reply to the questions could keep their answers as succinct as possible. I invite Mr. Youssef, if you'd like to make an opening statement.
Thank you. On that note, Convener, I'll keep my opening remarks brief. Can I, first of all, offer the committee my sincere apologies for my absence at the previous committee, unavoidable due to illness. When I last appeared before the committee in October, we shared a mutual desire to see a focus by the ScotRail Alliance on improving performance to the levels we expect, but of course, more importantly, the passenger expects. I had demanded a performance improvement plan intended firstly to stabilise performance and then, of course, to improve performance thereafter. At that last hearing, I reported that the moving annual average, the public performance measure, was at 89.6% against the contractual trigger of 90.3%. That moving annual average has improved to 90% by period 10, 0.3% from the target, which will lift ScotRail out of improvement plan territory. We're seeing encouraging signs that the current four-week period that we're in could potentially see a further increase in the moving annual average. In terms of the performance improvement plan, our latest information is that over 86 actions have been complete. The remainder of actions, the majority of them, vast majority of them, are underway. Shortly before Christmas, members will have noted that we look to thank passengers for their patience during a difficult period with the offer of a free week's travel to season ticket holders. I believe this offering is a demonstration alongside our tireless work on the performance improvement plan of our commitment to ScotRail's passengers and services. There will also be further discounts offered to weekly and less frequent travellers, whether for work or for leisure, particularly using the ScotRail smart card for journeys. All of this is backed by £3 million of funding, £1 million, of course, more than many were calling for. At the time of the announcement, I made it very clear that we would bring forward further details of the scheme in early 2017. I was also clear at that stage that there will be a contribution from ScotRail as well as from the Scottish Government. Members will see shortly more details on that, confirming £3 million of funding, and of course a little bit more in terms of detail around the offering for season ticket holders, both monthly, annual, and indeed for weekly holders as well. Finally, I would just like to conclude, Convener, by just saying a few remarks on another topic which has had a fair bit of coverage since I last appeared, and that is the further devolution of Network Rail. Convener, I'm strongly of the view that greater devolution of Network Rail's functions to Scotland will deliver better outcomes for passengers and the taxpayers. I have therefore charged Transport Scotland with establishing an expert panel to provide practical advice on how we can achieve that outcome in a manner that fully accords with Network Rail's reform agenda as set out by the UK Transport Secretary Chris Grayling last summer. With that, Convener, I am of course happy to answer any further questions, any questions you or other members may have.
Thank you, Minister. first question is going to be from Stuart.
Thank you very much, Convener. I've just looked up the PPM figures, and at the moment for today, ScotRail is running at 93%, which is 4% ahead of the GB figure. I do look at them every day. There's been only one day this month where I found ScotRail behind the GB. Does this tell us that the performance recovery plan is working? I mean, if we end the day with 93% for the sake of argument, presumably that will replace the day in the moving average a year ago that was rather worse than that, and hence will be contributing to improvement? Or are there still issues we should be concerning ourselves with?
Thank you. I thank the member for that question, and of course I would expect no less of him than to go into the technical detail of PPM. What I would say is that his broad question about the performance improvement plan, yes, since that improvement plan, as I said in my opening remarks, we first saw stability, and then, of course, we've seen now improvement over the last few periods, which is encouraging. Not at the place I want it to be. 90.3% is the target to lift ScotRail out of the performance improvement plan territory, therefore, of course, but logically no longer requiring an improvement plan. So they're still 0.3% away from that. I think Phil hopefully explained this when he was, Phil Vester explained this when he was in front of committee last, that the moving annual average, of course, the reason for that is it takes in seasonal variations, and that is the point of the moving annual average, calculated between periods and then, of course, moving there. It's a rolling average. The point of that, of course, means that if you had a very good period 11 last year, therefore you have to have a better period 11 this year in order to see some element of improvement. Period 11 last year was fairly good, and therefore making huge leaps in performance improvements might be challenging. But as we currently stand, the performance, if it stays at a relatively high level as it is today, then we should see some upward movement and performance at the end of this period as well.
Thank you for that. I also note the sleeper performances with the other franchises running at 100% for the fifth consecutive day. They have, of course, only five trains, so it's not perhaps... They have a long route, but let's move on. Just very briefly, Abellio and Transport Scotland are both engaged in improving performance. Are there particular issues that Abellio and Transport Scotland have at the top of the list of things that they're looking at to continue to improve performance?
Well, the improvement plan was really split into those broad sections around, those three broad sections around infrastructure, you know, which is largely, of course, under Network Rail, rolling stock, which is the train operating company, and then operations, which is also responsibility of the train operating company. So there's as members know, 249 actions and even more initiatives, actually, that feed on from those points. So there's just emphasis and priority going into those 249. Some of those, inevitably, as the performance improvement plan details, will take a long time. You know, kilometres of cables that need replaced for signals, for example, can't be done necessarily overnight. Of course, members will understand that. So there's a real focus on that and those three broad areas: infrastructure, rolling stock, and operations. And we're seeing, as we said, some improvement. And there also has been a focus on, I know from Phil Vester and the team, on those initiatives which improve the passenger experience, perhaps skipping stops is an example of that. So we saw about a third reduction between the last period and the period before that, period 9 and period 10. So that's positive as well.
Okay, John, I think you're coming in next.
Convener, morning, Minister. Acknowledging the information that it came out with Mr. Stevenson's question, Minister. Nonetheless, the public would be interested to know what, if any, sanctions had been applied to Abellio for failing to meet contractual punctuality and cancellation targets. Are you able to outline that, please?
Yes, I mean, I can. Look, first of all, it's probably worth saying that it's obviously within the train operator's best interest that performance is as good as it can be. Reputational damage means, of course, less people take the railways. If less people take the railways, that obviously impacts on their profits. So there's a inherent self-interest for the train operator to, and I must also say, from speaking to Phil Vester, the management team, right the way through to those on the stations, conductors, drivers, I've had spoken to numerous members of staff in ScotRail, and they are hugely committed Nobody is lackadaisical about this. They understand the, you know, the reputational damage that has been done to the railway, but also they want the best passenger experience themselves. So, you know, there's a self-interest, I should say that right from the offset. In terms of what other sanctions can be applied, I think it's been well rehearsed in the public that, you know, ultimately, of course, if performance dipped to certain levels, then there could be termination of the contract. Now, even if it didn't get quite to that level, you know, performance, for example, will be one of the things, excuse me, that will be discussed when it gets to when we get to discussions around the breakpoint. So when we have those discussions, we know the breakpoint's 2020, discussions, of course, will take place before that. Of course, performance will be one of the measures that is looked at. So if performance consistently isn't matching up to where we expect it to be or is not improving, then that will be part, and I must stress that, of the consideration of the breakpoint. On top of that, maybe the last thing I'll say, because I know the convener wants us to be succinct, is the ORR, the regulator, also has the ability, if they feel that an improvement plan, that a train operating company is not making all the efforts practically possible, is not exerting all effort that they practically can to achieve that performance, and they can investigate themselves. So the regulator can also investigate. And then actually the final thing I'll say, of course, in terms of standards in the railways, people know about our Squire regime, that robust auditing regime which has been lauded across the UK, which of course if ScotRail, when they fall behind on certain criteria, of course have to make a financial contribution. And they have done to the tune of Squire sitting at 2.06 million once deductions are taken out of that.
Okay, thank you very much, Stephen.
So I think Jamie wants to just drill down on the contractual obligations. Sorry, yeah, Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. I think the Minister answered quite a lot of my question in that previous answer, actually, so I won't dwell on it too long. But I think it's important to understand specifically what actions you can take if there is consistency in failing to meet the target. Is it true that if they rise above the 91.3% that the improvement plan stops or continues? I think that's something that was quite unclear.
Yeah.
And the second part of that question is just if they do continue to fail to meet that target but are some way above the you know, the trigger for you know, the default limits in terms of the contractual limits, there's sort of no man's land in the middle, which we wonder what you know, what action you can still take if they're in that zone, if you like.
Yeah, I'm going to go back to my original point. I think it's a really good question as well, and I'll come back to the performance plan. But the second part of his question, you know, I go back to the fact that it's in the train company's inherent interest to make profit, of course, to improve that. I mean, I'll just maybe read from the ORR's latest letter, and they do talk about the fact that they'll be meeting with the ScotRail Alliance again next month, so they meet with them regularly. And they say that it remains the case if at any point you fail to provide evidence that you're doing everything necessary, in brackets, to the greatest extent reasonably practicable, to deliver the performance improvement plan or achieve your regulated performance outputs, then we may initiate a formal performance investigation. Now, they're not at that stage at all. In fact, I should reiterate and re-emphasise that ScotRail are demonstrating improvement in the moving annual average and the reduction of skip-stopping across a number of measures. They are improving, so it's going in the correct trajectory. So, and that ORR letter, I should say, recognises that and says they recognise the efforts and the recent upturn in performance. To answer your question about that kind of no-man's land, as you described it, as I said, from our perspective, you know, there's a number of things that we can do. Continuing the performance improvement plan, there could be a formal investigation from the ORR. But again, I just go back to the point that inherently it would be out with the train operating company's interest to allow performance to fall to that. And we have no evidence of that happening. Performance is going in the right trajectory as opposed to the wrong trajectory. On the first question, which I thought was very good one, what happens with the performance improvement plan if for example at the end of, you know, the end of the railway year they are out of improvement plan territory, they're 90.4, 90.5, whatever they are. My view would be, currently speaking, that I would have a discussion with ScotRail, and of course there would be a change in perhaps personnel at the top of ScotRail. I would have a discussion with ScotRail And because some of the actions in the Performance Improvement Plan are due to continue into the next railway year, i.e. beyond the end of March, I think it would be sensible for us to keep monitoring that Performance Improvement Plan as a live document. So that would be my opinion on that. But, you know, of course, once we get to that stage, first we just have to focus on getting to that 90.3 and then take it from there.
Thank you.
Okay. John, I'd like to just take John on and Rhoda, is it that your question specifically on the improvement plan? Okay, very quickly. Minister, you are giving very full answers, for which we appreciate. I would ask you to appreciate that we're less than a quarter of the way through the questions and time is quite of the essence. Rhoda.
Just a very short question and short answer. Do you believe you'll reach the target, 91.3, by the end of March?
Well, the first target is 90.3. That is what we've said. The target is to get out of Performance Improvement Plan territory. So as Phil said a couple of weeks ago, they feel confident that by the end of the railway year, they should get to that 90.3. That would be the first target. When they get to 91 or 91.3, that will be certainly later
so
down the line.
So it won't be by March for 91.3?
Well, I would say the target of 90.3 will, you know, is what they're aiming for the end of March, not 91.3. And that's been made clear on a number of occasions.
Okay, but you will reach 90.3 then by the end of March?
Well, it's not me, ScotRail, whether they will reach 90.3. Certainly when Phil was here in front of committee a couple of weeks ago, he was reasonably confident. I'm not saying that will be an easy target for them to reach, but certainly we're pushing them to reach that 90.3 by the end of the railway year, if they possibly can. But as long as they're showing improvement trajectory, that is what I want to keep seeing.
So that wasn't a yes or no, but...
John.
Phil Vester leaving, Alex Hines arriving. Any comments?
I mean, I wish Phil well in his new endeavours. I've enjoyed a good relationship with Phil. There was a period of around 4 to 6 weeks where he was phoning me every day at 7 a.m. at my insistence on just hearing about the morning peak. So I probably spoke to Phil more than I spoke to just about any other member of my family or friends. So I built up a good relationship with Phil. I think he's very committed to the railways. And continues to be, so I wish him well. But also I've heard some very, very good things about Alex Hines, not knowing him personally, but speaking to those in the railway industry, he comes with a very formidable reputation.
I mean, I think one of the things I appreciated about Phil Vester was, you know, he was pretty open, straightforward, he had a very good handle on the practical aspects, you know, how things were actually going, gave us, I thought, good answers at committee. So I'm hopeful, and I hope you can reassure us that Mr. Hines will be, you know, equally open and frank with the committee.
Will certainly be the direction or what I expect them to do, not just with committee, but I think communication with passengers is vitally important in this role as well. So again, he comes with a good reputation on those fronts, and we'll look forward to that continuing.
Thank you.
Moving on to a slightly different subject, Peter.
Good morning, Minister. I'm going to ask you about the project delivery. And
there was an Ernst & Young report that stated that increases, the original funding was $1,131 million, and that increased to $1,510 million, an increase of $379 million. But when we asked Phil Vester about these figures, he reckoned that wasn't an accurate figure, and the correct number he reckoned was $293 million that the project deliveries had risen by. What figure do you recognise?
The member for the question. Actually, both figures are technically correct. They're just looking at different periods. So the Ernst & Young report looks at the major projects, the five projects that it details, that some that began in period four, towards the end of period, control period four, and will end in the early part of control period six. And that total that was mentioned, the kind of $379 million, takes into account that entire period. The figure Phil used, I think it was 297 or thereabouts, was just control period five. So that was that figure. So technically speaking, both figures are correct. They're just looking at slightly different periods.
Okay, right. I can understand
that. Sorry, I kind of understand that. It seems like statistics and I can't remember what the other thing they're called, but I'm a bit confused by that. Damn lies. I wasn't sure that I was going to accuse anyone of saying that.
Well, thank you, convener. That seems to be
perhaps it would help the committee if we could see that laid out, exactly how that figure is broken down, Minister, and that could be supplied to the committee after the meeting, if I may. Sorry, Peter, sorry, not to interrupt.
That's fine. I mean, I can understand if it is relating to different periods, then obviously that could be a correct analysis of the thing. But the Ernst & Young report also makes a number of recommendations for action by Transport Scotland. Can you provide an update on the implementation of these recommendations to date? Where are we with them at the moment?
Yes, I can. And of course I will if the committee wants me to write to them on further details. But, well, Mr. Chapman understands it, so I'm pleased that at least there is some understanding. But I'll try to lay it out in a little bit.
Suggesting that I need to lift my intellectual level to Mr. Chapman.
Well, I didn't want to suggest.
I'm going to take it that you didn't mean that.
I certainly didn't want to suggest.
And I will leave you to answer Mr. Chapman's question.
I didn't want to suggest that, of course, at all. What I would say to Mr. Chapman's question is yes. In terms of there was a number of recommendations made at the Ernst & Young report, and a number of those, quite a significant number. Were for Transport Scotland, so I'm pleased to say that yes, all of those are being undertaken at the moment. Where you could break them down into three very broad headings is ensuring that there's better quality of reporting from Network Rail. The second one would be around the governance, which I think is probably the most important, so governance around current projects, so the establishment of the Major Projects Portfolio Board that is chaired by the Chief Executive of Transport Scotland, Roy Brannan. He sits on that, chairs that, has an overview, and therefore there's a little bit more in terms of accountability between Network Rail and indeed Transport Scotland. And the third would be improving how we do major projects, both the development and delivery for the future. So we know we have Control Period 6 coming in 2019 2024. The way we do major projects is simply not fit for purpose. So therefore, we're consulting through the HLOS process, the high-level output specifications, we're consulting on that to determine a better way of delivering major rail projects. So they're well underway. They come under these broad three categories. And as we say, we'll continue to make the improvements and follow on from the recommendations that the Ernst & Young report highlights.
So you're content that as we go forward, you'll come forward with more accurate figures than what we've received in the past. That must be the aim, surely.
Absolutely, you're right. That must be the aim, because the way it is currently done is simply not fit for purpose. So it must be the aim. Now, can I promise you absolutely that there won't be a single overrun on a single project in the future at all? You know, of course, I wouldn't make that promise, but we certainly should be aiming. Absolutely, without doubt, to have better cost estimates in the beginning before projects, when they're at that developmental stage, and then following on into the future. So yes, he's right, that should be absolutely the aim.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Richard, I think you've got the next question.
Yep, good morning, Minister. You wrote to the UK Secretary of State for Transport in November 2016 asking for control of Network Rail to devolve it to Scotland, and basically he wrote back to you and said no. Because they didn't believe that it should be going beyond the Smith Commission. Can you explain what benefits you think that full devolution of Network Rail would bring to Scottish Rail passengers and freight users, and how do you envisage, or how would you envisage, it being structured, regulated and funded if it was devolved?
Yeah, it's quite a lot in that question. And what I would say is the general aim of devolution of Network Rail and the benefits that would accrue due to that devolution is not just something that's shared by the Scottish Government. Now, I'm pleased that it is shared by the Scottish Government. It's shared by some of other political parties around this table. But on top of that, you know, maybe I can just read out the quote from the Reform Scotland think tank and Tom Harris, who was the co-author of that, former Labour Transport Minister. He said, "We need fundamental change to the governance of Network Rail. The Scottish Government is responsible for the strategic direction and funding of the Scottish Rail network. But this responsibility cannot be properly exercised while Network Rail remains answerable to the UK Government. Reform Scotland believes that Network Rail in Scotland should be fully accountable to the Scottish Government, and that means it must be devolved." So that's coming from, you know, an independent think tank. Various reports into Network Rail, the Shaw Report, McNulty Report and others, have also made similar overtures around devolution of Network Rail. So the point is that the principle is a well-established one across not just the Scottish Government, but across many experts in the rail industry. In terms of the actual benefits, again, I could probably split them into three broad categories. Firstly, around timetabling. Timetabling is essentially important for rail delivery. That timetabling is currently done in Milton Keynes, We think it'd be much better if it was done up here in Scotland, closer to Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government. What we've just talked about with Mr Chapman in terms of major projects delivery, of course, infrastructure projects still reserved again to down south, whereas we think if that responsibility over major projects was up here, we could closely align and much closely align with the aims and objectives of Scottish Government and Transport Scotland. There would be a clear line of accountability. I think there could be considerable efficiencies made there. And then the last benefit really would be the devolution of headquarter functions, largely around the legal, the property and capacity issues as well. So those would be the three kind of broad benefits around timetabling, major projects and HQ functions.
Richard, are you happy on that's no follow-up on
no,
that?
No, no follow-up.
Can I just say, Minister, I'm a little bit confused because when we had Phil Verster in, and he was asked specifically on this subject, he said there'd be absolutely no benefit from the control of Network Rail moving back to Scotland. And my gut feeling is always to go with the man on the ground that's making the system work. Could you just explain to me why you're not taking his advice on that?
He's employed by Network Rail, and of course Network Rail have a standard view on this. I've spoken to Mark Carn on this, and I don't want to misrepresent Mark Carn at all. He can speak for himself, but it's fair to say that it doesn't quite share the same level of devolution, the ambition that we have up here in the Scottish Government. So there's an understanding that if someone is employed by Network Rail, then of course they would rightly and understandably speak on behalf of Network Rail. I wouldn't expect Phil Vester to be speaking on behalf of the Scottish Government and saying what our Scottish Government's ambitions are. My point remains, convener, if I may, respectfully, that this is just not just the position of the Scottish Government, this is a position of other political parties, of respected think tanks, of various reports that have gone into Network Rail as well. So I can only explain to you what our rationale is for our aims and ambitions, and of course others who represent other organisations can do it on behalf of their organisations.
I accept the comments you made. Certainly the comments, I think if you look back at the official record, and he was here representing everyone, whilst he may have been employed by Network Rail, he was saying that there was such a good working relationship between all the organisations that they were pulling together as a team and making it happen. And he stressed that it was a team involvement and he could see no benefit. Maybe it's a political suggestion. Sorry, it's Rhoda.
Just on that issue, I think one of the questions I was going to Phil Verster last week was that Network Rail had been the cause of some of the problems and delays and performance issues. But given that Network Rail's performance in 18 other areas are worse than in the ScotRail area, would it actually make a huge difference if they to performance, because it suggests that the other 18 railways are performing an awful lot better than ScotRail to bring them up above.
Look, I accept the point that, first actually the convener's point, that I don't want to say that the alliance hasn't been successful. This alliance, of course, is certainly creating relationships that weren't there previously. So that's a good and that's a positive. And I notice the Secretary of State for Transport in the UK government wants to kind of replicate the alliance model across different franchises in England and Wales. So that's, there's some positive there. What I would say on Rhoda Grant's question is it's still the indisputable fact that 54% of the delays, as the Reform Scotland report highlighted, are still coming from Network Rail. Now, my simple, really presumption on that is that, with 54% of delays being attributable to Network Rail, the fact that we're paying 100 million towards the headquarters, the fact that they are responsible for those major projects, which, as we know, have this cost overrun in the hundreds of millions. Yet, if you just let me finish this point, yet we don't have direct accountability over Network Rail. For me, that is just not an acceptable situation.
I'm not arguing with that. What I'm arguing with is that would make a step change in performance, because actually their performance is worse in 18 other areas. So therefore, if their performance was better in ScotRail, it suggests that ScotRail itself is failing behind those other companies.
There's no doubt that in some measures and for some part, I think about 37% of the delays were caused by the train operating company, but still it remains the case that 54% of the delays were down to Network Rail. I'm not saying that if you had devolution that magically you would click your fingers and everything would be okay. I'm simply saying having that direct relationship with Network Rail, I think would help us to be able to overcome some of the issues, which would help to tweak up performance. I get frustrated myself when I hear from passengers, of course, understandably frustrated about signal faults, about track failures, and I hear it day in and day out, so I understand why passengers get frustrated. It causes me to get frustrated, and I wish I just had some direct accountability and some direct control over Network Rail so that we could have a closer relationship to tweak
not
up.
Not making a difference.
No, I think, as I said just a moment ago to the convener's remarks, I think the Alliance is making, you know, creating positive relationships. I just think further devolution, more devolution could make even more of a difference.
I think, if I may, I'm going to leave that there because I think that that's something that some people have aspirations for, and I accept your aspirations. It may not be reflected everywhere. I'm afraid I'm just going to leave it there, Stuart, if I may, and move on to John for the next question.
Thanks. I mean, if I'm allowed a supplementary on the previous discussion, you said that...
No, I would ask you to move on to the question that we'd identified purely because of time, John.
Yeah, I actually think we're all doing okay for time, I have to say, but I accept your ruling. Concerning Edinburgh-Glasgow Improvement Project and Queen Street Station, which are obviously interlinked, I mean, there has been some suggestion, especially from the ORR, that, both have slipped. Can you comment on either or both of these?
Yes, I mean, the TAWS process, which we're currently going through, is a complicated and a complex process. We know that from previous TAWS orders that they're really straightforward. There was a slight delay in receiving the submission for the TAWS from Network Rail, about a three-month delay. That, of course, then has an accumulative effect in terms of delays. You have to go through the statutory steps, as you know, the public local inquiry and so on and so forth. To answer your question as succinctly as possible, the passenger and the commuter will want to see the key outputs of quicker journey times, i.e. that 42-minute journey time, and longer trains, those eight-car trains on the network. They are scheduled for December 18. I am determined, and I know ScotRail, Network Rail are focused on reaching that December 2018 deadline for the longer trains and the shorter journey times.
Okay, and so Queen Street Station, when are we expecting that to happen?
Yes, and this is where Phil Vester was correct a few weeks ago, and as identified by various reports that we've put out, that there could be a risk of slippage when it comes to the end stages of development. So some of the aesthetic redevelopment of Queen Street, nothing that would affect, for example, or shouldn't affect the longer trains, i.e. the platform extensions, the longer trains, the shorter journey time, but there may well be some level of slippage. Now, we're working very closely with Network Rail, obviously the other stakeholders involved, to try to identify what that level of slippage may be. But Phil was correct a few weeks ago in front of committee to say that there could be a risk of that.
He said, we expected the TAWS unit to report back to the Minister in July of last year, but the revised date for the report back is January or February this year. When is that report happening?
So the TAWS report has been submitted to me as a Scottish Minister. The approach going forward, and I should say there was a delay in us receiving the submission, I just have to re-emphasise that. The TAWS report is with me and has been with me. I have then tasked officials before making that order to go back to speak to the stakeholders to ensure that there's some nuances and modifications that have been made to that order to ensure that, give them a further opportunity to comment on that. But what I did say when I met with some of the stakeholders last week, I said that we're looking at making that order within weeks as opposed to months and months and months down the line, so we should shortly be able to make that order. What I don't want to do is make it, and then because of the modifications and perhaps some of the nuances that have been changed in that, then have more objections coming in. It delays and accumulatively delays the project even further.
So if this report was delayed by 6 months, does that mean the start of the work is delayed by 6 months?
It was delayed, I mean, the 3 months really, when we received the submission and therefore some accumulative delay after that. But no, it doesn't mean because of that, then automatically there's a six-month delay. As we said, I'm working with Network Rail, working with the partners to determine a better timetable. But the key thing for passengers and commuters who want to see longer trains and who want to see a shorter journey time, we're still very focused on reaching that December 18 deadline.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Minister. We're going to move from Glasgow, I think, further north. Gail.
We are indeed. Good morning. Aberdeen, Inverness and Highland Main Line. Just to go back to the Network Rail Monitor and looking at progress on both of those lines, are you satisfied that we're ensuring the best value in the development and the delivery of both of those projects, given that there has again been some slippage and some escalating costs?
Yes, I mean, we're still at, you know, I'm disappointed by the slippage that takes place on any of our projects, and I highlighted that very much at the time. But yes, what has been detailed in the Ernst & Young report stands.
Very good, thank you.
John, did you have a follow-up on that? You indicated you may.
No, not on this occasion, thank you.
Okay. We'll leave that one there, and Richard's got the next question.
Can we turn to the rolling programme of electrification? Maybe you could tell me, is it Network Rail that does this, or you, or who's responsible for electrifying the rail?
Fund it, but Network Rail carries out the work.
Okay. So with three projects, Rotherham to Coke Bridge, which was completed in 2014, Stirling to Dunblane and Alloa, the one I'm very interested in, the Shorts line electrification, under both the Alloa and the Shorts one under development. But we're getting told the Shorts budget remains at risk due to a number of emerging risk factors, including, well, in Shorts, mining redemption, land risk assessment arrangements, further compliance issues. The ORR has recently highlighted concerns about the risk to the budget of the Shorts line and the Stirling, Dunblane, Alloa electrification projects. Can you outline what Transport Scotland is doing to minimise these risks to the budget for these proposals?
I think it's, and I understand the member's interest in the specific route. What I would say is, on the back of the Ernst & Young report, where there was seen to be found cost increases, the main recommendation that we took forward was to establish that major projects portfolio board. That gives the chief executive of Transport Scotland, who of course reports directly to me, gives him overview of all of these projects and gives a level of involvement and scrutiny that previously didn't exist. So when it comes to the Shorts line you know, delivery, the current delivery date is still that March 19, but he's absolutely correct to have said that the cost increased from 80 million to 160 million, which again for me is just an unacceptable cost increase. Now that is a Network Rail increase. We know that electrification projects across the United Kingdom have suffered cost increases. In fact, some electrification projects across the UK have had to be scrapped because the cost has spiralled. Now Network Rail will give their own answers around why that's the case, and the ORR will give their reasons for why they think that's the case. Around compliance issues and other such matters. But fair to say, we're keeping a very close eye on that through the Major Projects Portfolio Board, and we would expect that current deadline to be met.
Did I mishear you there? Did you basically say that the cost has doubled?
Yes, for Shorts electrification from 80 to 160.
You know, I know we've done a lot of mining in Shorts, but not as much as that.
I mean, this has been an inherent problem in electrification projects, but that doesn't take away from the fact that it shouldn't happen. So it goes back to the answer I gave to Mr. Chapman earlier in the session, that there must be a better way to do major rail project development and delivery. The current process for me, the current model for me is broken, and therefore we need to have another way of doing things, hence why we've put a consultation out, which is due to end in February, due to close in February, around how we deliver major rail infrastructure. So I agree with his his shock at the increase in prices. I find it unacceptable.
But we're still saying, just to finish off, that possibly could be done by March 19?
That's the current position, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Right, just Stuart, I think, is going to come in. Sorry, I'm just sort of slightly surprised with the increase of price that we heard there. Stuart, sorry.
Phil Vester, Phil Vester told us that the electrification to Dunblane is being delayed by issues related to the Victorian pedestrian bridge at Stirling that crosses platforms 2 and 3. Now, if you're not briefed to give the answer now, a written answer probably would do, but we'd be interested to know just what the current timetable is on that. And my own suggestion is whether the Dunblane and Bridge of Allen and Dunblane trains could alternatively be brought in at the Alloa platform, which would avoid that pedestrian bridge, and then a little crossover to take it back to the main line is being considered. However, that may be more than you wish to say now. A written answer probably would do, Convener.
Minister, that I would accept Stuart's suggestion that a written answer on that, on the detailed specifics of that question, may be appropriate.
Yes.
And I will get our clerks to write to you about that.
Okay, yes, I'm happy to do that. I should say, Convener, from, you know, you expressed before that question some surprise at the figure. Can I just say that that figure was made public in the Ernst & Young report and has been public since the publication of that report. And just on Stuart Stevenson's point, yes, December 18 is still the target, again, in the Ernst & Young report for the completion of Stirling, Dunblane, Alloa, and on his wider point about bridges and other proposals, of course, I'll happily accept writing to the member on that.
OK, we're going to move on to the next question, and Rhoda's going to lead on that.
Yes, can I ask about the 3 weeks travel, please? When will this happen, and how will it happen? How will people claim it?
On the back of this session, because I wanted to make sure, of course, that we gave some detail to the committee first. There will be a little bit more information that will go out from both myself and ScotRail, and the £3 million initiative of the free week will go ahead this summer. We always said when we announced this in December that further details would come in early 17. Some of those details, I can say, for example, the deal will include particularly extra incentives for those on a season ticket if they move from the paper-based system onto the smart system, which is, of course, something we want season ticket holders and others to do. So the annual season ticket holder on smart card will get a free week for them, or indeed for a friend or a member of their family. Plus, they'll also get two off-peak return trips anywhere in Scotland. If you're a monthly season ticket holder, you'll get a free week added to your next season ticket purchase, plus one off-peak return trip anywhere in Scotland. If you're a weekly season ticket holder on smart card, you'll also set to benefit with a complimentary one-day return ticket anywhere in Scotland. And a further offer for leisure passengers is in the pipeline for later this year. But what will happen is they'll be able to claim that in the summer period. However, in advance of that, at least 6 to 8 weeks, excuse me, in advance of that, ScotRail will heavily advertise when that free week will be able to be claimed. So there's plenty of time for passengers and commuters to take advantage of that offer.
For smart card holders, it's not for all season ticket holders.
No, it will be for season ticket holders, but there's an additional advantage and additional incentive for smart card, because obviously we want to try to transfer and incentivize people to transfer from the paper-based system to the smart card system. So no, it will be for season ticket holders initially, the monthly and annual. I've also mentioned their weekly passes, but also for less frequent travelers, so even if you don't have a season ticket. But there'll be additional incentives there if you're on the smart system as opposed to just the paper system. It's a way of trying to incentivise people to go onto that system, which of course is a shared aim across the political parties and indeed across stakeholders.
We heard from Phil Verster that he didn't know how they were going to deliver that. He didn't know what systems they would use. Why was this announced before there was a plan drawn up on how you would deliver it?
I don't accept that premise in the slightest. I mean, there's the broad principles of this free week were well established in advance of announcing it. That was £3 million, that there would be a contribution from ScotRail and a contribution from the Scottish Government, and that there would be a free week.
Didn't know how they would deliver it. They would try and make it work.
Again, I don't accept that in the slightest. The principles were there would be £3 million, there would be a contribution from the Scottish Government and ScotRail. There would be a free week as well, and that it would benefit monthly, annual season ticket holders, as well as weekly and less frequent travellers. Now, that was the announcement that was made. And, of course, every time I made that announcement in public and indeed in any written communication in advance of the announcement, I said that more details would come out in early 17. Actually, opposition members wanted us to make full details of this available on the 2nd of January when those fare rises took place. We didn't do that because, of course, the fare system is a very complex one. All you have to do is pick up the newspapers this morning and you will see the Rail Delivery Group are saying that there's 16 million different fare algorithms and they're working to simplify that. So it's this complex system. Therefore, we're working through with ScotRail and we'll be able to announce details as we go on.
So I've announced some details here. So you don't know how it's going to be delivered, is what you're saying? So what you're saying is you don't know how it's going to be delivered because it's so complex.
No, it's a complete misrepresentation of what I said. What I said, there is the details of it are well established. We have the funding absolutely in place. We've already said that they'll be able to claim in the summertime. I've given details of some of those incentives and discounts at the moment. And of course, further details for those that are less frequent travellers, for weekly travellers, will be given in due course. So absolutely, we are living by the commitments that we made earlier this year.
Minister, could I just drill down on part of the information that you gave to Rhoda there? Could you explain to me how much is coming from ScotRail? And where it's coming from their budget.
I'll just read from the press release that will probably be released shortly from Cathy Craig. She's a commercial director of the ScotRail Alliance. Her quote is, "We are pleased to be contributing £1.8 million of Squire funds for this significant benefit for passengers. This is a sincere token of our appreciation for their patience and understanding as we progress one of the biggest infrastructure improvements for Scotland's railway since Victorian times." And then there's more to the quote. So I think that coming from ScotRail obviously shows that £1.8 million of the Squire funding will come from there. £1.2 million will come from the existing Transport Scotland budget.
Okay. Now, I know Mike Rumbles wants to drill down onto the actual use of the Squire Fund, but before we go there, can I just understand, Phil Verster, when he came to us, said that the Squire Fund had about 800,000 in it. That's what he said was available. So that you're looking for another £1 million from the Squire Fund. Hold on, sorry, if I can just follow the logic, so I understand it. And the Squire Fund is actually made up of contributions for when ScotRail fail. So what I don't understand, we're in a position where you're saying that it's going to come from the Squire Fund, but you want ScotRail to improve, but you need them to fail to be able to fund it. Could you just explain that to me, Minister?
Yes, it's an incorrect understanding, but not based on your understanding, but based on what was said in committee a few weeks ago. In fairness to Phil Vester, he predicated what he said with the caveat that he was doing it from memory and that he wasn't entirely sure. And in fairness to him, that's why the figures used were slightly incorrect. The Squire funding sits at £2.06 million once you deduct the 834,000, which is being spent on particular station improvements that have been agreed between ScotRail and the Scottish Government. So once you deduct that, the unallocated funding is £2.06 million, as I said in the Parliamentary Chamber last week. From that, there's been an agreement between ourselves and ScotRail to use £1.8 million of that. Now, that would leave, of course, in the order of 200,000 to be spent, but as you rightly say, Convener, every 4 weeks that fund is topped up. Now, would I want it to be the case that absolutely ScotRail meet each of those robust criteria so they don't have to pay Squire funding? Absolutely, and if they do that, there'll still be £200,000 left in that Squire pot or thereabouts. But realistically speaking, we know that those funds will continue to come because some of those improvements will take time, inevitably. So that's the position that we're in.
Okay, so I'm going to move it on to Mike, because I think the critical point is here is what concerns me and I think may concern Mike is that the Squire Fund was set up for specific purposes. And it seems to me because there are no trustees or no management structure for it, that it's difficult to see how that fund is properly used. Mike, could you?
Thank you, Convener. Can I just follow on from that point before I ask another question? I mean, Phil Verster, when he came here, was quite clear, and it surprised the members of the committee, certainly surprised me, when he said that the contractual position is that the decision about where to invest the Squire Fund sits with Abellio ScotRail, not with the Scottish Government. And this £1.8 million, he said he had, quote, not agreed to. And then 48 hours later, he resigns. And now you come to the committee to say, and I quote you again, we have the funding already in place, unquote. So I don't know why members are laughing. This is a serious point.
because the insinuation is an absolutely incorrect one.
I think it is unfair.
Well, it's absolutely unfair to make a suggestion that because after Phil Vestal's coming to committee that somehow he resigned as a result of that. That was the insinuation you were making, an absolutely incorrect one, an absolutely false one to have made, and I think, frankly, a crass one to make as well. Phil was moving...
Minister, in fairness, I think you have a right to disagree, and I would like to keep, and would always seek in the committee to keep comments on disagreements rather than on making it too personal. So I'd ask you to withdraw that and maybe answer the question that Mike has asked.
Okay. Well, I certainly don't agree with the insinuation that was made around Phil choosing to take on another opportunity in Network Rail. What I would say on the question that was asked, when it comes to the contractual position, when it comes to spending Squire money, so taking the £834,000 that has been allocated, generally ScotRail will come with propositions, but it will be a discussion between Transport Scotland and indeed, of course, then coming up to Scottish ministers, but Transport Scotland and ScotRail, and we'll come to an agreement on where to spend that money. Contractually speaking, it is up to the Scottish ministers how that money should be spent, but generally speaking, as we have always done, we will do that in consultation, in discussion with ScotRail.
Could I ask, therefore, if I've got something wrong here, Phil Vestal comes to the committee, says, and I'm quoting from the official report, that the contractual position is the decision about where to invest this money sits with Abellio ScotRail. You have just said that it's up to Scottish ministers. There's obviously, and I'm not insinuating anything, I'm actually making a point to you, and I would like you to address. It's not insinuating anything. I'm trying to get to the facts here. Phil Vestal comes to the committee, makes that point. You've come to the committee, makes the opposite point. There's obviously a disagreement between the two of you. Would you not agree?
There's not a disagreement. What if you read Phil's remarks, he said he was working from memory. I would ask the member to bear that in mind, that he was working from memory. He doesn't have, I don't imagine Phil has a photographic memory of the contract in his head. So he was working from memory. I'm more than happy to provide the member with the wording of the contract.
Well, that would be very helpful. So he was obviously wrong when he said it was under... His understanding was the contract, it was his decision and not yours.
I'm happy to write to the member with the contractual.
That would be very helpful to find out exactly what the contract actually says.
Sure,
that would be lovely.
Happy to do
Thank
that.
You. The main point I'm trying to get at here is...
Just before you go on to your next point, I'd rather you didn't write to the member. It's a matter raised at the committee. I'd rather you write to the committee, and we will make sure he's got it. Sorry.
Contract is in the public domain, but I'll extract that point and highlight it to
that would be very helpful. This is such an important point because, as you've just again said today, the Squire Fund is used for station improvements. And when I asked Phil Vestal in my region, in the Northeast, particularly, there's a real issue over Inch Station, which I have written to you. I'm sure you'll reply fairly soon. The point was, I said to him, is this money used for disabled access at, for instance, Inch Station in my region? Now, it will be used for disabled access in other stations across the country as well, I'm sure, if it's not just for in station. But the point I'm trying to make is he gave us the clear impression that this fund was for those sort of developments, and that's why he wasn't agreeing with your access to that fund, let's put it that way, for a different purpose. That's the disagreement I'm trying to get at. Is he wrong?
Well, 1.8 million is unallocated. The 834,000 from the Squire funds are allocated. Therefore, it would be absolutely correct to say that the 1.8 million is not impacting on projects that are being delivered. And of course, that fund continues to get topped up every 4 weeks, every railway period. In terms of DDA compliance, in terms of working to make stations more accessible, The main funds for that, of course, are the Access for All Fund, which is a DFT fund, but there's a ring fence pot for Scotland. And that fund, which goes into the millions, tens of millions, is helping to refurbish and indeed make more accessible a roundabout in the order of 25 stations in Scotland up to 2019. And indeed, on top of that, in the franchise, there is a minor works fund, which is around circa £350,000, which is specifically there to ensure that accessibility is improved among stations. So there's an access for all, which is in the tens of millions of pounds. There is a minor works funds in the hundreds of thousands of pounds. There is Squire funding that is already allocated. The 1.8 million, of course, is unallocated, and there continues to be top-up of Squire funding as well. In terms of Inch Station, which the member mentions, and he has written to me, and of course I will give him a response in due course, I am more than happy to meet with him to see if we can come and put forward a proposal for future access for all funds. There are some difficulties with that. I know the member has spoken to me about what he thinks is a more cost-effective solution, and I will happily hear him out on that.
Yeah, I mean, I just want a final try on this. It will be a final, I understand that. I understand what you just said about all the other funds and everything that's available for disabled access to stations, etc. But Phil Verster was quite clear when I asked him. I asked him, and the official report, it's in there. I said, this fund could be used for things like disabled access at stations, so like at Inch. So what I'm saying, I hear what you said. I'm not disagreeing with what you said at all. But the point I'm making is that this £1.8 million could be used for that, and what you are doing is using it for something else.
The 1.8 million is unallocated.
I know.
834,000 is allocated. We're not touching the 834. The 1.8 is unallocated. For works on disabilities and improvement to access, Access for All would be the correct fund, as well as the minor works fund as well. And that Squire fund will continue to be topped up. And even once we deduct what we're deducting for the fares, there's going to continue to be 200,000 in that, plus whatever is topped up every 4 weeks on top of that.
So, I mean, I think, to, if I may, just there is, Jeremy wants to come in on it. I think that there's some concern on the management of the Squire fund and how it's used. Sometimes it's used to do various things in allocated funds, and sometimes it's used to do things that are to help situations as they arrive, and it may be to help the government. I think it would be really helpful for the committee, and I've certainly done some research to find out the management of the Squire Fund and how it actually is managed and who's responsible for it and who decides how it's spent. It would be helpful if you could make that information available to the committee.
I'd be more than happy to convene. Can I just make the point also that before this franchise, when Squire money, when for example the previous executive Liberal Democrat coalition, when they had the franchise, Squire money was just put back into the centre, the central pot. It wasn't ring-fenced to reinvest back into the railways. So what we've managed to do is get an agreement, of course, to reinvest this back into the railways, a significant step forward. But what I will do is write to you around about how decisions are made and any other details around the management of Squire. And if you want to come back to me, if you think there's some detail missing, then of course I will do that. But I would like to emphasise the main thing for the passenger, of course, is what I announced in December and continue to announce, that we have £3 million of funding, which is going towards a free week and further discounts. And I think that will be well welcomed.
There's a very small supplementary from Jamie.
And it's not a political point by any means, but does the minister think that 1.8 million is the best use of the best way of spending that money, if you like? So I appreciate there's 800,000 allocated to existing projects, and I dare say some of those projects are good and will improve the passenger experience. Is it his view that the best way to spend the balance of the Squire Fund is on free travel? And it's a very simple, straightforward question.
Well, first of all, it's not the entire balance. As I said, there would still be some money in the Squire pot, and it would continue to be re-topped up. But yes, I think it's a good qualitative benefit for passengers who've had to suffer disruption. Some of that has been planned, like closure of Queen Street Tunnel, and some of that, of course, has not been planned. And, you know, the incident in November in Haymarket Station, for example, caused huge disruption. So I think it's a good way to thank passengers and commuters for that, and it's been welcomed from the passengers that I've spoken to.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Minister, there's a couple of questions that we haven't got to, and I'm afraid our time is particularly short. We have other witnesses coming in this morning, and it will be that we will write to you and ask for answers to those questions. I would like to ask you if you would like to make any brief statement as a result of giving evidence this morning to the committee?
No, nothing really to add, Convener. I thank the members for the questions. Obviously, we'll follow up on what needs to be followed up. As I said, I was keen to give committee a little bit more in terms of details on the free week before it goes out more publicly. But then if there's any follow-up on that, of course, I'm always willing to come in front of committee or indeed to take give any written submissions that are necessary.
Okay, thank you, Minister, for attending today's meeting. And I'd now briefly like to suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to change in the room. Thank you. The third item on our agenda this morning is to take evidence on the Scottish Government's draft climate change plan. The plan was laid on the 20th January 2017, and the Scottish Parliament has a period of 60 days to consider this document. The committee will be carrying out scrutiny in collaboration with three other committees and will be focusing on agriculture, forestry and transport. Last week, the committee launched a joint call for written evidence, and I would encourage as many people as possible to send us their views. We'll begin today's session by looking at the climate change as it relates to agriculture, and then we'll be looking at forestry. Now, I would welcome, and I'm going to start, I think, thank you very much for reminding me. Before we start with introducing the witnesses, I would like to just check on declarations, and I'm going to have to make a declaration that I refer members to my register of interest in that I am a partner in a farming partnership. Does anyone else?
I am a partner in a farming partnership as well.
And Stuart?
I have a tiny registered agricultural holding from which I derive no income.
Okay, thank you. So I'd like to welcome Professor Pete Smith, Chair in Plant and Soil Science at the University in Aberdeen. Peter Ritchie, there we are, Executive Director of Nourish Scotland. Stephen Thompson, who is the Agricultural Economist at the SRUC. And Alistair Nairn, who is Farmer and Environmental Spokesman for the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association. Now, Andrew Bauer will be joining us. Unfortunately, he's been held up by a transport delay, but as soon as he arrives, I will ask him to join the group. Now, I've mentioned to the committee already that we've got a huge amount to cover this morning, and I'd really appreciate if members and witnesses could keep their questions and answers as succinct as possible. So, can I ask the witnesses to indicate to me if they'd like to speak or respond to a particular question? And Andrew, I've already introduced you, and I'm glad that you can join us before the session started. So the first question comes from the Deputy Convener, Gail Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for coming along. In a letter to the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee in November of 2015, the Scottish Government stated their intention to secure widespread participation in the development of this plan, including engagement on potential scenarios, and they used the words to build collective ownership and responsibility. How do you feel that yourselves and your organisations have been engaged in the process of the development of the plan?
And I think that's because that's really all of you will have an input. If I could ask you very briefly, I don't know who wants to start. Andrew, you lead on.
Certainly my experience has been one of the most involved processes of engagement. I really think Scottish Government deserves some credit there for the amount of efforts put into gathering the views of stakeholders. Certainly NFU Scotland would have no complaints about the extent to which it's been consulted on this.
Can I just remind witnesses, you don't need to press any buttons. You'll be picked up as soon as you start to speak, and so don't worry about the buttons. We'll control the buttons. Pete, do you want to go?
Okay, yes. I mean, I agree with Andrew. The government's made efforts to engage people. My sense on particularly the agriculture part of the climate change plan is there's not been enough background papers really setting out the context, giving us international comparisons, the direction of travel, really giving a context to the discussion out of which we can then generate concrete plans and concrete suggestions for reductions in emissions. The Times model doesn't work particularly well for agriculture, but I think I draw the committee's attention to some publications like the DEFRA statistics on agriculture and climate change, which give a much more detailed sector-by-sector picture of emissions intensity and also farmer attitudes towards climate change. And a paper like that would have provided useful background, I think, to the discussions about agriculture and climate change.
Stephen, would you like to?
I would say that the CAP stakeholders group, so the Future StarCakes CAP stakeholders group, where there's wide industry representation, that this has been discussed. So the stakeholders have got good knowledge of this. On coming back on Pete's point, the Climate Centre for expertise on climate exchange have produced a number of background reports for policy. It's whether or not the wider stakeholder members are actually aware of those background reports, but they are available on CXC website. So there is a lot of background information available that research have been really feeding into government on this topic.
Can I just say also, just so you're all aware, we have had written representations from I think most of you here today, for which we're extremely grateful. Sorry, Alistair.
Well, the SDFA is only too happy to participate in the government's CCP plan, and we will do our best to move along and see that we can do our best for the Scottish farming industry and the government climate change plan.
Because there's two Petes, do you mind if I call you Professor and ask you to answer that?
Pete, but that's fine. So I would echo Stephen's point. I think there's been excellent engagement with the scientific community in order to make sure that these targets are evidence-based. There's been consultation on the TIMES model, so the TIMES model was introduced and feedback was solicited on the TIMES model. And Climate Exchange, for which I'm the science director, has been involved in providing some of the underpinning evidence, calling on a bunch of the institutes that are contribute to Climate Exchange. So those reports are available on the Climate Exchange website.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to actually move on because I think that's quite a useful summary of the position and ask Stuart to move on with the next question.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I want to just turn to the Farming for a Better Climate that was run by the SRUC and really to ask concisely if that's had a beneficial effect, but more to the point, has what's happened in that scheme, which was limited in the farms that it was working with, has that lessons from that moved on to other farms? Have it been picked up by others in the industry?
Yes, the Farming for a Better Climate programme was initially for climate farms, and the lessons that I've learnt from them are it's quite an eye-opener actually, where it's common sense approaches. What I would probably classify as best practice or good practice, and farmers adopting them have managed to make significant financial benefit or financial gains and also significant carbon footprint reductions. The lessons learned, so I asked for some statistics on this, and I think last year there were about 880 people attended the events. There was 88% of them said that they would adopt some measures that from the things that they learnt are written down. Some of them, they include soil management, soil sampling, biomass, hydro, herd health planning, selecting breeding heifers differently, a whole range of things and lessons that can be learnt from this that the agricultural community themselves have reported. One of the criticisms will always be that it's the early adopters that will attend these meetings, and how then do you disseminate that knowledge further? And I know that there's a meeting between Sandy Ramsey, who's the head of the Farm Advisory Service for SRUC, and the Scottish Government, along with Rebecca Oddsley, who leads on Farming for a Better Climate, to see how we can engage with the wider farming community and get the messages further out. But there are key messages here. And there are a number of case study examples on the Farming for a Better Climate website, which go through the process, what the benefits have been on the farms. And as I said, for some of those farms, it's quite a significant financial saving, as well as climate change.
Indeed, I was last minister, I did visit one of these farms, and I saw that for £10 on a whiteboard inside of the diesel tank, they'd got a huge multiplier of the money back, just simply recording when people took these. But on the financial point, is there evidence as to how much money people can save? Because that's likely to be an early and obvious motivator for farmers to move on an agenda that helps the climate change agenda. I guess later, when we
tackle some of the more difficult things, it might not be so obviously financially beneficial. But are the farmers who are not yet taking action really aware of the financial savings that they could be making for, I suspect, in the early stages, comparatively modest efforts?
Stuart.
As I said, were quite significant. So for Tor Farm, there was £37,000 savings with 11% carbon footprint reduction. Glen Kilry saved 11,000 overall, 10% reduction in carbon footprint. Others have had significant. Upper Nisbet saved £10,000 just from knowing their nutrient value of their manure and actually applying that using GPS soil sampling. There are a lot of easy wins if farmers adopt. Now, I would always refer back to things like getting fertility levels up in cattle, i.e. some farms are down at less than 80 calves per 100 cows you have, but the top range is up at 98, 99 maybe. And it's how do you then stimulate those people to change? That's the hardest thing, or the biggest challenge that we have is, some people want to change, and some people will adopt to those changes, but I wouldn't say drag the others, but stimulating others to make changes is more of a challenge, and others might have more thoughts on that.
Could we perhaps just hear from Alistair then briefly? Yeah. Does he think farmers will pick it up?
You, gentlemen, I was going to come in straight afterwards. Is if you want to speak, and I'm very keen that you all get an opportunity to speak, please try and catch my eye. And I'll either indicate that I'm going to bring you in or I will regretfully, if time is running short, shake my head. So, Alistair, if you'd like to talk about the actual answers on that and how to specifically move farmers forward to achieve some of the goals.
Well, at the moment, I'm changing my own farming policy. I'm shifting away from having high productive cows that need a lot of maintenance to a cow that can stay outside much longer, where I don't need to bring in loads of straw, bring it in for miles away. I winter them outside, and I'm going from a high input, high output system to a low output, low input, low output system. And that is the way I see it. It has to go in the hills.
Yes, Pete.
Yeah, I think everybody will agree that this is a cultural change issue here that we're needing to address, and really trying to get climate change higher up most farmers' agendas is important. I think the DEFRA survey, which we quote in our report, is interesting, that about half of the farmers that they surveyed across the UK didn't think climate change was anything to do with them. So it wasn't something they were going to take into account in their business decisions, or they'd already done enough, or there's nothing they could do. So I think that cultural change stuff is something which the Farming for Better Climate and other initiatives are sort of at the foothills of, but we need to invest much more resource in the cultural change program over the next 10 or 12 years. It's not just about technical knowledge, it's also about attitudes change. And I do think we need to boost the advisory and extension services significantly if we want to make a difference. And as we say, we need very strong leadership, both from Parliament and government, but also from the colleges and from the farming leadership, saying this actually matters to everybody. And yes, it will save you money. We're spending a lot more money than we need to on bag nitrogen. We could reduce that and save farmers tens of millions of pounds across Scotland. But we need all to get more efficient and more thoughtful in the way that we use resources.
Pete, just before you move, because I think we've all read your submission, the question is, and the point you've made there is that it comes down to leadership. Do you think it is still at the stage where it says leadership rather than legislation, or do you think we're at the legislative stage? And then I'm going to come to Andrea, and a very brief answer on that would be very helpful.
Okay, I think leadership is crucial. Legislation on its own won't make change happen without leadership. You can penalise people for not doing things, and we need to make things like soil testing compulsory because it will help. It will help more farmers do it. There's no point in every farmer who's got a bit of rough grazing doing it. We need the farmers who are on productive land where they're using fertilizers to put on the ground to do it first of all. They're the key people to do it. And we've talked about using the individual social material framework to really understand what are the factors that help farmers shift and what the factors that inhibit them shifting. Is it lack of knowledge? Is it what their colleagues are doing? You know, is it just that the economics don't seem to work out for them?
Okay, Andrew.
I think a key thing to bear in mind here is that on average there's 1.2 full-time equivalents on Scottish agricultural units. That is a tiny workforce that has to deal with a very wide and in some cases very deep body of regulation, guidance, never mind keeping the farm business going. So a key barrier in my head anyway is about people having the headspace, the time to reflect on the changes that they're going to make in their business. It's great that people like Alistair and Pete are making those changes, but for a lot of people they're kind of caught on this wheel and they're simply just trying to keep their existing business going. And we need to create these opportunities and the people with the right knowledge in the right place, presenting it in the right way, that allows people to stop and think, well, actually, you know, rather than trying to sustain my system as it is, I'm going to make a positive change that's going to benefit my business and the environment. So, you know, you wouldn't expect me to come here and say that we would welcome lots more regulation. But at the same time, you know, we are conscious that there's certain things out there that at some point in time you may exhaust every other opportunity. But I don't feel we've yet got to that point. We have an awful lot of people who have adopted early on, as Stephen said, good practice, but we need to help other people have the time and the space to do the same.
Stephen, if it's very, very brief, because we have a huge amount of questions.
Just a final point was that in addition to the 9 climate change farms, there's also the soil nutrient network farms. So there's currently 3 of them where soil sampling occurs and shows best practice around soil sampling. That's going to be extended to 12 farms across Scotland under the Farm Advisory Service. And people that attend that then get a 30% reduction in their soil sampling. So there's a number of different things ongoing. And I know people focus on farming for a better climate, but there are other initiatives out there that are ongoing.
I'm going to come back to soil sampling because it is a point that has run across all the submissions and something that the committee, I think, will have an interest in. John, can I ask you just to move to the next question, please?
Yes, I mean, I've got 4 questions, but I think I'm going to try and combine them to speed things up. I mean, I happen to be on the Economy Committee as well, and so yesterday we were looking at this as well, and there's definitely a feeling in some quarters that agriculture is getting off very lightly in this whole plan, and that other sectors is largely compulsory. Other sectors are expected to make much greater savings, whereas what we're told is that 12%... reduction in carbon emissions from agriculture is the lowest, smallest proposed reduction of any sector in the plan. And I mean, I think it was pointed up at the Clare Committee as well. A lot of the language in here is very much conciliatory and working with rather than compulsory. For example, page 136 of the plan, 14.2.3, we will work with farmers. We will have encouraged farmers by 2020. By 2030, most farmers will know the nutrient value of their soil. So, I mean, it's just, would you agree that agriculture has been given a very gentle approach compared to other sectors?
So, 2 notes of touch and agriculture getting away lightly, I think, is what you're saying, John. Professor, can I bring you in because you haven't had a chance yet?
Yeah, so it's a more difficult sector to decarbonise because there are greenhouse gas emissions other than carbon dioxide that are involved. So in most sectors, we can decarbonise them simply by using less energy and less fossil fuels in the processes that we do to support those parts of the economy. Because nitrous oxide and particularly methane are large components of the greenhouse gas balance of agriculture, that makes it more challenging to reduce those particular emissions. It's not just a matter of decarbonising the energy that we put in. There are some biological processes, particularly enteric methane, enteric fermentation that occurs in ruminants, which produces methane, nitrous oxide emissions that occur from nitrogen in the soil, whether that's through mineral or organic applications. So whilst I take the point that the sector may have got off lightly compared to others, it is actually a more difficult sector to decarbonise, and this may reflect the smaller targets in this sector compared to some of the others.
Alistair.
Well, according to what I'm told, and it's in the plan itself, that emissions have dropped in agriculture by 25% since 1990, and that's entirely due to a drop in agricultural output. So that means that the industry has shrunk by 25% since 1990. Now, that drop has got to be replaced somewhere, and it can only be found by importing the food that we don't produce ourselves.
Okay.
So you're saying it's not possible to increase production without increasing the emissions and so on, and the effect on the climate?
Could you say that again, please?
Are you saying it's not possible if you increase the output again, is that automatically have a negative effect on the emissions and the climate plan?
Well, it means that if you've got to increase your output on less acres, then you've got to probably put on more slurries, more fertilisers. There'll be more tractors working there. So it may well, one may cancel the other one out.
Okay, sorry, can I just work all the way along, give John, if, just everyone a chance to come in on that, and then I notice the professor wants to come in and Richard wants to come in. So maybe Andrew, if you go next.
I would say, in addition to the points that the professor's made, there's the way that the emissions are allocated between different sectors, and you know, that's been flagged up in our submission, and I'm sure probably by everyone else here. You know, the work that farmers do to manage forestry, to plant new forestry, to manage peatlands, and to put up renewables on their farm isn't featuring in the emissions envelopes that are in the plan. So we wouldn't see that reduction as a full account of what agriculture will do. I take the point that it is, on the face of it, it looks less ambitious than for other sectors, but I think given the challenges, the biological challenges, the way that things are accounted for, and the pressures, both economic and workforce, on the sector, and a desire with other agendas like the food and drink agenda to grow this part of the economy and grow our food and drink sector and make our rural economy stronger, I think it would be foolhardy of us to just plough ahead solely on the basis of maximum reductions.
Yeah, I would just reiterate some of those points, and I kind of knew this was going to come up in terms of this reduction since 1990, so I quickly went and looked at a number of animals that have changed. We've had a 23% reduction in dairy cattle, 7% reduction in beef cattle, and a 34% reduction in sheep numbers. In sheep alone, you've seen roughly a 5% increase in lambing percentages, and the system is changing. So the system is moving away from a very extensive hill-based system on with lots of smaller sheep to much larger, heavier sheep producing more animals each, which means it's more efficient. And it's more efficient from a carbon perspective as well. So although you might be putting more inputs into a heavier crossbred ewe, you're actually getting greater output as well. So there's a lot of complexity in this, and I would reiterate Andrew's point here about the envelope for agriculture, how renewables, peatland, etc., do not get captured for agriculture, yet they are some of the key drivers in those targets.
None of you have mentioned the time it takes either to move from heavier, badly producing cows to better producing cows. But Pete, I'm going to bring you in, and then, if I may, I'm going to bring Rhoda and Richard in at the same time. No, Pete, sorry, it's you, Pete. I'm going to refer to the professor as professor.
Okay. Absolutely. I think we have got off slightly lightly in agriculture. I think we could do more, but we don't underestimate the challenges of achieving those gains. We think we could really have a push on nitrogen, and nitrogen is 5% of our total greenhouse gas emissions in Scotland, and at the moment our nitrogen use efficiency in Scotland isn't as high as it could be. You know, we could do something on nitrogen which would save farmers money, but also make a dent on those emissions. But this is about increasing farmer knowledge, and as Andrew says, these are all nearly all very small businesses, and it's it's not like the construction industry or other industries where you've got big players who, once they decide to change, change. We're talking about lots of actors changing. So what we keep saying is, yes, we need to be more ambitious. We need to raise the bar for agriculture. But to do that, we need to invest a lot in advisory and extension services to help farmers make those changes, which will make their businesses more profitable.
Professor, do you want to come in, but briefly, if
just very quickly on John's question about can we not, if we increase production, do we necessarily therefore increase emissions? There's been historical decoupling between production and emissions through efficiency improvements, and you can see that globally from 1960 onwards. So it is possible to do farming more efficiently to decrease emissions per unit of product. But we must also remember that if we, you know, the quickest way to reduce emissions in the agricultural sector is to close it down and import all of our emission, import all of our food. But then we're exporting our emissions, and that's no benefit to the climate and disastrous for our economy. So there has to be a balance, and I think Scotland perhaps has a role in leading the you know, low emissions intensity agriculture and to promote our clean green food and drink. Which would be beneficial both for our internal market and for our export markets.
If I go to Richard first, do you have just, and then I'm going to come to you.
Beth actually covered the point I was going to say. You know, at the end of the day, it's saying here, reduction in the number of cattle and sheep, reduction in the amount of grassland being ploughed, has resulted in the reduction in their emissions. You know, so if we took the DAF suggestion, and I'm not suggesting you're DAF, Professor Pete Smith, but that we shut down the whole industry, then we'll save all this, we'll reduce our emissions vastly. My view is, population is going up. You know, I agree with Alistair Nairn, we have to increase our production of food and to save imports. You know, so where does the two balance? I'd be interested to know that.
Before you answer that, could I just bring Rhoda in? Because I think that there may be a tie-in with the two.
Yes. I mean, given that if emissions falling is down to us having less production, I mean, greenhouse gases is a global issue. It's not a countrywide issue. So if we're just simply importing and that looks good on our figures, it's looking bad on somebody else's figure and causing the same amount of damage, how do we then, I suppose, encourage our farmers and crofters to get involved in looking at ways of farming better that encourages production but also cuts greenhouse gases? And I think it was Andrew that said, you know, you're talking about very small holdings where it's one person. They don't have time to go on the course that teaches them all this. How on earth do you get that knowledge out there? Because people will make a step change if they know, but if they don't know, they'll continue doing what they're doing.
Can I suggest that, Pralit, because that suggests a huge list could come out from all of you. maybe we could try and, I could ask you each to come up with one particular thing that you'd like to see concentrated on to try and deliver this change. And I'm going to go to Pete to start with, because I think he's already indicated where one of the areas he thinks very strongly about.
Yeah, I think nitrogen is something we haven't focused enough on in Scotland. If you look at the nitrogen balance in Scotland, we take off about 200,000 tonnes of nitrogen in our crops and our pasture. And we put on about 200,000 tonnes between the manure we put on the ground and the clovers and beans and what just comes out of the air anyway. And then on top of that, we put on 160,000 tonnes of bagged nitrogen. So we've got a surplus of 160,000 tonnes of nitrogen if you take Scotland across the board. Now, that's out of line with our European competitors who are doing much better in their relative surplus of nitrogen. So we could bring that down over a period of 10 years or so to something. We could probably halve that without any loss of productivity at all, but just by using nitrogen and animal manures more smartly. And also getting food waste digestate back on the land too. So we could just be much smarter with nitrogen, and that's it.
Perfect. Stephen.
Can I just come back to John's point there about whether farming has got off lightly? If you reflect back to what I said about the Farming for a Better Climate farms, 10% and 11% over, you know, per annum reductions, and that's working with specialists and probably on pretty good farms to start with. So there might be higher gains elsewhere on farms that have got more to gain, but it shows you it is a difficult challenge. On your point there, the question that Rhona raised was, I would agree, nutrient budgeting is probably a key to a lot of this. Understanding what your soil is capable of, understanding what goes off your soil in regards to silage, grazing, etc., and understanding what you then need to put on after your slurry. So understanding those kind of things from a farming perspective. The regulatory approach for NVZs didn't particularly work because farmers saw it as a regulatory tool, put the piece of paper into the drawer and never really revisited them. They're now starting to understand the benefits of that, but it's taken a long time from that regulatory tool to have an impact.
Andrew.
I think partly we need to have a bit more faith in farmers and their capacity to change and their willingness to change under the right circumstances, and that might be about demonstrating or explaining to them, this is where we want to get to. You know, it's down to you to decide in your individual business how you're going to get there. Here are some suggestions. There's also a place for, I think, a lot more peer-to-peer knowledge transfer, you know, farmers learning from one another, not just through the Farming for Better Climate model. And if I can abuse the microphone for a moment, just to return to John's point, we have a really fundamental decision about what it is we want from our food and farming sector in this country. You know, we could chase efficiency at all cost and reduce our emissions, I'm quite sure of it, high input, high output systems. Does that sit well with how our brand is perceived in different markets, both domestic and foreign? We could chase a low input, low output model, and I'm not decrying either of these models, they have their place. And that might sit very well with the brand, but it might do both positive and negative things for individual farm businesses and for the rural economy and its output. And I don't think we're not in the business of five-year plans in this country, but you know, we do need to be mindful that we have some pretty big agendas, different ideas of what the rural economy and our food and farming sector is about that are not, I don't think, yet reconciled and settled in people's minds.
Andrew, you haven't quite come back with the golden bullet from your perspective on what's going to help us get on climate change. Would you like to have it?
There's no such thing, I'm afraid. I don't believe there is. I think it's a lot of little things.
Alistair.
Well, I would like to bring the committee's attention to a paper that was written by a fellow called Graham Sait, and it was on the health of the soil, and it's known as humus. It's a glue that determines whether the rivers run brown when it's rain, and it's a thin veil of topsoil that sustains the soil. It's all. Now, we're losing the fertility of our land, and I think it's very, very important that we get this right to stop greenhouse gases going away from the soil and into the atmosphere. So I think that we should be looking at the fertility of the soils, because the decrease in topsoil has had a huge negative impact beyond global heating. Recent research has revealed that if we maintain our current loss of 3 to 5 tonnes an acre annually, we have just 60 years until it's zero. So that's not a very long time. And I would say there's so many people writing these papers out there, who do you actually believe? But I think we're faced with quite a serious situation now where we have got to look at this, the fertility of the soils in the very near future.
Thank you, Alistair. Professor, would you like to come in on that?
Yeah, so I think quantifying the greenhouse gas emissions per unit of product in Scotland, we have a fantastic climate and great soils for very efficient production of food. So if we quantify our emissions and we compare those to some other areas, we can show that Scottish food actually has the potential to be a low emissions food per unit of product, and we could use this to gain a share in the market. The other issue that I would like to bring up, and it's an extremely controversial one, is that nowhere in the report are demand-side measures considered. Demand-side measures are things like reducing waste, but more importantly, dietary change. So the last IPCC assessment report considered dietary change as a method to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And dietary change would largely be a move away from livestock products to consume more plant-based products. Now, it's known to have a large technical potential, and since the IPCC assessment report, a number of papers have been written about this. It's controversial, but there is a large climate mitigation potential here, and it also has the potential to deliver healthy diets for the future. So I think this is a big omission in the current assessment of what is possible with the climate. We, of course, have to consider all of the social justice and policy issues associated with that. But given that our diets in Scotland are not the most healthy in the world, it could help co-deliver to both the public health agendas and the climate change agendas.
Right, Professor, thank you. That will shake everyone up. And on that, I'm going to come back on, keep saying come back on the soil issue and fertility issue, because I think it's a theme that's running through. Peter, I think you've got the next question. Sorry, John, you're happy with that?
My one's mainly targeted, I think, at you, Alistair, and it's great to see a fellow North East farmer in the Parliament here. The Tenant Farmers Association has been particularly targeted in this plan. You know, why do you think that is, and what are the particular issues that affect the tenanted sector in addressing these issues of climate change?
Well, I would say that I could address this maybe in one or two ways. The first thing that I would say is that we're moving away from long-term tenancies to short-term tenancies, something like maybe 5-10 year contract farming, grazing leases. That's the main ones. Now, nobody's looking after, if you've a 10-year lease, you will put on the nutrients onto your soil that you need to get you probably to year 8. After that, you're not going to put lime and Scott Foss and these things onto your land for somebody else to get the benefit of. So that land, the production capability of that land falls away. It's the same with probably a short-term tenancy. A 5-year tenancy, you'll put them on year 1 to get the benefit of them, but who says that the next, if the landowner takes it back, who says that he's going to put anything onto that soil to bring up the fertility? And that would be quite a big issue as far as I can see.
I recognise exactly what you're saying, Alistair. The short-termism is a hugely bad thing for the health of the soil. To go back to your previous point, we need to recognise healthy soil as one of the best ways forward. So how do we overcome that issue then? Is there a way forward to get away from that short-term view of you know, short-term lets? How do we address that?
I think it has been created by the subsidy system. Because the landowner, he has kept the single farm payment on the land, and he has let out the land. He doesn't feel any obligation to put anything onto the soil to keep up the fertility of his soil, and he leaves it up to either the grazier or the leaseholder. Now, if it's a grazing lease, The tenant is just going to put on the type of fertiliser that he's going to get the most benefit out of. He's not going to think of the fertility of the land beyond the time when he actually is using it.
Very good.
Okay. Thank you. There's a theme building here which will come to. And Stephen, do you want to come in very briefly on that?
Reiterate that point. I think there's a lack of confidence in WAGO compensation, and if there was adequate support or belief in that system, so when a tenant gives up and gets compensated for the improvements meant to include soil, and the tenant is meant to replace or put the soil back in the same condition as they received it. But there's lack of lack of belief in that system and how it's actually operational.
And just as an observational point, it's sometimes quite difficult to quantify that, and specific soil sampling makes it very difficult to see what nutrient levels that you've increased. So, and I think that is an interesting point. Stuart, can I just ask you to move on, because you had some questions on meat and dairy, I think.
Yes, I don't think we need to take too long on this, but I particularly want to perhaps to ask Professor Pete. In earlier remarks, there was reference made to the methane, in particular outputs from ruminants, and I've been told, I am so far from being an expert, you will never plumb the depths of my ignorance, let me say that straight away. But I understand there's quite significant variability that's genetic, but also the bacterial mix in the rumen between different beasts as to the methane output. Is there an opportunity for us in Scotland, who've taken the lead in certain kinds of research, to actually develop beasts that intrinsically emit less for the same input, or perhaps fine-tuned diet? Is there really an opportunity that matters there? Yeah. Or is it just back to the point you made, we should be eating less meat and hence producing less methane?
Yeah.
Professor, can I suggest that you stick to generic animals rather than actual breeds for fear of upsetting some breeders across Scotland? Professor?
Of course. So there is some variability in the amount of methane that's produced, but the methane are produced by the microflora, the gut bacteria, and the gut bacteria are the things that allow ruminants, generically, to break down the cellulose. So to break down the cellulose in the grass and to convert it into protein, and methane is a byproduct of that. So there's no way of getting away from ruminants producing methane. You can get breeds that work better and some that have less and some that have more per unit of input. You can also manipulate these things to a certain extent by varying the diet. The best way to reduce a methane emissions per unit of product is to get the animal to slaughter weight as quickly as possible, which tends to push us so that the methane emissions per lifetime of that animal is less. But that pushes us in the direction of ever more intensive production, where we bring the animals in the opposite, actually, of what Alistair was saying. So in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, that may make some sense in terms of emissions intensity, but in terms of what we want from our food, potentially I think that's a step in the wrong direction. So I'd say there's limited potential to improve breeds to do this, and there's lots of work going on in New Zealand and also in Ireland to look and see how much this is. We're going to have to put up with the emissions if we want to consume ruminant products, and if we want to do that in a way that is consistent with a clean, green way of doing it, we probably have to avoid just looking at the problem through greenhouse gas blinkers, because it would push us potentially in the wrong direction in the way that we want to go in Scotland, potentially to produce clean, green livestock products that we would want to consume ourselves and to export.
And ask if there are options to absorb the methane further down the digestive tract and bind it into some of the waste output of...
Go further down the direct.
No, I know it doesn't.
So it's burped out, basically, right. So rather okay. than farted out.
Thank you.
Yep.
Right. thank you for the mechanics
the
of that.
Technical terms.
Andrew, I think you wanted to come in.
Could just for a moment on this point about eating less meat... I think it's important here to look at to be clear about the language that we're using here. The information that we have from people at the supermarkets is purchases of unprocessed meat tend to go hand in hand with increased purchases of vegetables. So people are buying cuts of meat and they're buying vegetables to go with it. I think if we were reducing the amount of processed meat that we were eating, there's, you know, certainly value in looking at the detail of that, but you know, obviously the devil will be in the detail. But if we simply talk about reducing meat consumption, then the producers that are producing high quality unprocessed meat on our hills, not only are we reducing the amount of their product that we're selling potentially, we're also running the risk that we substitute that with processed meat and the veg consumption goes down alongside it. So we do definitely have to consider these demand and supply side issues and understand that consumer behaviour will be a major driver in all of this.
Pete wants to come in.
I think it's all right. I don't want to argue about the veg consumption. We're doing quite a lot of work on how do you increase veg consumption independent of whether people eat more meat or not. But I do think we just need to put a marker down that reducing meat consumption globally is essential. Within Europe, it's really important. There are signs it's already starting to happen, which I think is quite helpful. But we do need to separate off this idea. Yes, we absolutely need to support Scottish farmers to produce, you know, very green beef and lamb and to eat some of it ourselves and export the stuff we don't need to eat. But I think we need to separate off this idea of production and supporting farmers to produce a very good product from the fact that we individually should probably eat a little bit less. And I don't think there's any conflict between the desires of farmers to sell their product. You know, we don't have to drink all our own whiskey or eat all our own salmon. And we say we don't have to eat all our own beef.
I'm very glad to hear that. Stephen, do you want to come in very briefly?
I would just say that within the strategic research programme of the Scottish Government, there's quite a lot of research probably ongoing into finishing animals, the methane production. So there's the greenhouse facility, the green cow facility at SRUC. But on this issue of emissions intensity per kilo of product, what we have to remember is quite a lot of our livestock are in rough grazing scenarios. Rough grazing generally leads to higher greenhouse gas emissions than an intensively finished or intensively reared animal that's on a grazing system with cereals. We know we can finish animals at 11 months in the beef sector, but you can't sell it as beef. It's rosy beef or whatever it's called. So there's real issues in that the systems that we can make efficiency gains aren't being demanded. So we're told that bull beef is no longer really a demanded product, yet you can finish an animal very, very quickly. Now, this comes back to Andrew's point earlier on about the reputation of Scotland. Do we want the sort of the clean, green, environmental aspects which go with the brand, or do we want to actually reduce intensity, greenhouse gas intensity, and have a quickly finished animal that's intensively reared? These are fundamental questions.
Sorry, I'm going to bring Peter in, if I may.
I just want to redirect the thinking a wee bit. I mean, I'm all for healthy diets, but I'm also all for a healthy agricultural industry. And we've got to recognise that the vast bulk of Scottish agriculture is on land that only can grow grass. And if you grow grass, then you keep sheep and you keep cattle on it, and that's the only way forward for that. But another bit of this equation that we haven't really talked about is the health of the animals. We need healthy animals. We need to tackle disease issues so that of the number of calves and sheep that are born, most of them or more of them gets to the final slaughter stage at a healthy age, at a young age, and efficiently produced. And health of the livestock is vitally important. Whether anybody wants to comment on that, I just wanted to bring that in myself.
Can I allow two comments on that? It's just that we are very short time. Alistair put his hand up first, so in fairness, I'm going to let him go first.
That sheep's worst enemy is a sheep. If you have them in an intensive farm situation, then you're going to have to vaccinate them for everything under the sun. But if you have them out in an extensive situation where they're no coming in such close contact with each other, then there's less disease. You don't need to be injecting them for every possible scenario. So I would say that we definitely still need livestock on the hills in extensive farm situations where we can get good, healthy breeding stock to probably bring into to the more intensive systems. So one sort of system complements the other, if you want to put it that way. But I don't think we should be trying to intensively farm everything that we do.
I'm actually going to leave that there because I think it's a fair note to say that healthy cattle are good cattle. And sometimes pushing them too hard, or healthy stock, a good stock, pushing them too hard can be detrimental to what we're trying to achieve in Scotland. Jamie, I'm going to ask you to come in, but I'm going to ask panel members again to be very brief on their answers to this, because we have four more very important questions.
Thank you, Convener. I'll keep this quite brief. My question will link quite nicely into the next question anyway. So the overall climate change plan makes a number of assertions. It uses words like there are substantial potential economic benefits to the rural economy from the policy. What's good for the planet is good for your pocket, and so on. It talks very directly to farmers in terms of positive impact. But it also says that improved profitability could encourage greater intensification in farming. I mean, knowing that agriculture accounts for 19% of emissions in Scotland, it is the way that the government is selling this climate change plan to industry, a bit like selling Christmas to turkeys.
I'm looking for somebody. Pete wants to come in, and then Andrew.
Absolutely right that a lot of the things that farmers can do to reduce the impact on climate change will also help their businesses. As Peter said, having healthier cattle, getting, losing less lambs, all of those things actually have an impact on climate change and they help the farmers. So I don't think it's a missell. I think that's the direction we need to travel. There are some things you could ask farmers to do which would be so expensive and have so little impact on climate change they're not worth doing. But I don't think we're there yet.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would just echo that. I think also that those in government that are responsible for trying to deliver this and the research institutes out there in the industry are all, I think, quite convinced of the importance of sustaining agriculture in rural Scotland, and therefore I don't see any desire to use this as a Trojan horse to reduce emissions. We have to be careful that we don't do it badly and it has that effect. But I don't get any sense here that this is some way to drive emissions down by driving agriculture out of the rural Scotland.
Thank you. I'm going to leave that there because John Finney's got an important question which I'd like to bring in now, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. This has been touched on very briefly by the Professor, and it's about what's not in the plan. And I think, in fairness, I'll do a literal quote here. This is from written evidence to the ACCLR committee by the Friends of Earth Scotland, who say, and I quote, "The multi-stakeholder event held in December was of limited value since it was at a very late stage in the process after many policy options had already been eliminated for technical or political reasons." So the question is, do you feel that the full range of options were examined in developing the plan, and if there's anything that you feel should be in the plan that's not in the plan, please.
Andrew, you signified first.
Yeah, I mean, that event was pretty late in the day. I'm not sure that others, I can't speak for other sectors. I would say that within agriculture there had been a lot of events before that. There had been substantial discussion about a wide range of measures, and advice was taken from, I think, a lot of people around this table and a lot of others at those earlier events as to what was really workable, what had some mileage and what didn't. So I wouldn't share that criticism, certainly not in this part of the plan.
Pete, you want to come in?
Yeah, just as we said in our evidence, we'd like to see organics in there. It's in the organic ambition plan. It just didn't feature at all, and by December or something, it was too late to get it in. So if it's not too late now, we think organic should be in there as a major driver because it benefits farmers' pockets as well as benefiting the environment.
Does anyone else want to come in? Professor.
Yes. So I don't know why demand-side measures aren't there, but it's the only sector where demand-side measures aren't considered. So when we look at transport or energy, we're constantly looking for reduced consumption of those products. I imagine that consumption measures aren't here because they're so controversial, because food is such an emotive issue, and because it would be extremely difficult to affect change. Having said that, the science is unequivocal that it has a large technical potential, so I think it deserves more attention, particularly as our targets move through towards 2050, when we're going to need even more ambitious targets. I think that it will need to be considered at some stage in the future.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. The Deputy Convener Gail's got a question. Yeah.
I think just to finish and wrap everything up, in your opinion, how appropriate do you think the timescales and the policies and the plan are?
And I'm going to ask each of you to answer that, if I may. And who'd like to start? No one. Andrew.
I think that there's a kind of overarching approach in the agriculture section, which is about working with people over the next few years to build up that knowledge and capacity to change, and only thereafter looking at more strict mandatory measures. And I think that's right. I think if we went straight to those mandatory measures, I think we would get kicked back, and I think we'd get unintended consequences. So I would support the approach of trying to bind people to this process through demonstrating its value and only thereafter regulating. So no issues there.
Pete, and if I could encourage you all to be as succinct as possible. Sorry, I don't want to take away from the valuable information you're giving us, Pete.
I think we've not made much progress in the last 10 years on a lot of these issues, if you look at the numbers. And I think we do need, as Andrew says, we need a clear narrative about where we're going next with Scottish agriculture. And I think we do need to paint that picture that we want to have a, you know, climate smart, a low emissions agricultural sector in Scotland that produces really good food and that, you know, meets a lot of the different social goals we want. And we need leadership on that. And in a sense, then we can get these climate change targets in as part of that. At the moment, it reads a bit like a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a bunch of measures which aren't quantified in terms of how much they'll actually contribute to reducing climate change emissions. So it needs a narrative that really holds the thing together and says, this is where we're going with farming, and this is what it's going to do for climate change, and this is what it's going to do for other things as well. And I don't think we have that at the moment, particularly with the EU decision. But I think that's...
Stephen.
Yeah, I would say that on quantifying some of this, the uptake of carbon audits has been relatively weak to date. There's scope for 250 in the Farm Advisory Service. I think there's been 50 applications to date since the launch in September. So taking efforts that way might is positive, but it's going to take a long time to encourage people. Again, it comes back to this time element, how much time is going to take to encourage people to change their practices. With regards to some of the other measures, if we change the greening components of ecological focus areas, you'd suddenly get more legumes in rotations. So the fact that we have an August the 1st, you have to have two nitrogen-fixing crops growing. All of those measures are counterproductive in terms of what this is trying to achieve. So we need to look more holistically at what we do with agricultural policy, because agricultural policy is the thing that's driven all the changes I talked about earlier. It's change in ag policy rather than anything else that's really driving an awful lot of the changes. And we're moving forward into a period of uncertainty with regards to agricultural support, and there may be opportunities to redesign how we're doing things and do it better.
Alistair.
Many farmers are aware of carbon emissions, and many of them now have GPS systems on their tractors. Their fertilizer spreaders are much more efficient, I think they are aware of what's much more aware of climate change. Also, many farmers now do carbon audits on their farms already before they can get their produce into some supermarkets. So, I mean, I do a carbon audit every year. But I would feel that people who supply our industry have to be aware of the situation as well. And they have to do their bit as well. We're losing a lot of our protein now from the distillery industry, and because it's going into anaerobic digesters, and that protein will have to be replaced from somewhere else. And the only place I know where it comes from in any vast quantities is South America, so it's got to be shipped over there. And we are actually destroying our source of GM-free protein and replacing it with genetically modified protein. And I don't think that's a good idea.
I think that's a very good point, and thank you for bringing that up, because I know it's particularly relevant to to people in space. But Professor, could I ask you just to do a very brief
point? Yes, very, very briefly. I think that the timelines are broadly reasonable, as is the rollout of the policies and proposals. I think there's maybe been one or two missed opportunities in joining up the dots with some of these. For example, the soil testing to improve nitrogen applications could be rolled into also assessing the soil organic matter status, and also proposal 5 to increase carbon sequestration in soils. If we had soil testing that was routinely measuring all of these things, we would have monitoring and verification, as well as being able to determine the nutrient status at the beginning of every cropping season or every livestock production season for exactly how much nitrogen we need to add, or how much nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium we need to add. So there are some missed opportunities across them. The other one, I think, is on carbon audits. If this were more participatory, so that the farmers were doing this in groups using tools to understand how the carbon audit is put together and what their largest sources of emissions are, we've shown using the Cool Farm tool in the USA, just by getting farmers together, showing them how the tool works, the group learning has allowed them to reduce emissions by 16% over 3 years from organic egg production. With no targets. We didn't set any targets. We just allowed them to learn from each other, to copy what each other were doing to reduce those emissions. So if the carbon auditing was used as part of the engagement opportunities, we could help farmers to educate themselves about these issues, and as well as providing the baseline data that we need going forward.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm afraid our time is up, but can I make an observation that the one thing that has come through today and in a lot of your submissions is the whole issue of soil and fertility of the land. And I think it's something that this committee will want to look at a great deal more. I think what is important is ensuring that, and I understand that the difference is making it appropriate for the area of farming that we're in. For example, I very much take the point that was made in one about leguminous crops being grown in areas where they don't actually grow, doesn't actually achieve very much. So I think the whole issue of soil sampling is very important. I think it goes across the whole farming sector. And I believe, without consulting the rest of the committee, but I notice agreement from most people, that it is something that we would want to take a great deal more interest in. But I'd like to thank you all for coming here. If you feel that we've done you short of anything that you want to say, I would remind you the deadline is the 10th of February, and if you'd like to add further submissions, we'd welcome to have you. Thank you very much for coming, and I'm sure in the course of this Parliament that we'll be seeing you all again at some stage, but thank you very much. I'm going to suspend the meeting briefly, committee members, to allow the change of witnesses. We'll now continue with agenda item 3 by taking further evidence on the Scottish Committee's draft climate change plan. We're now going to focus on forestry. We're joined by Professor Robin Matthews, leader of the Nurturing Vibrant and Low Carbon Communities research theme at the James Hutton Institute. Gosh, that's quite a mouthful. Charles Dundas, Public Affairs Manager at the Woodlands Trust. Alan Carter, Chair of Reforesting Scotland. Stuart Goodall, Chief Executive of Comfor. And George McRobbie, Managing Director of Till Hill Forestry. I welcome you all to the meeting. We have a series of questions, and if you want to answer the questions, I'd urge you to try and catch my eye. I will try and make sure that you have equal chance to answer, and I apologise in advance if I don't get the opportunity to get you all in on a subject, but I would remind you the deadline for giving evidence, if you want to give additional evidence, is the 10th of February. So if at some stage you don't feel you get in, please submit further evidence. And the first question is going to come from Mari.
Thank you. And much in a similar way as what was asked of the panel for agriculture, it's really just how you engaged in the process of developing the plan. And also, given that the Scottish Government was looking that the process in developing the plan would build collective ownership and responsibility, do you think that it has achieved that?
Who'd like to go first? Okay, Professor.
I'll say something. The James Hutton Institute has certainly been involved. We do a lot of work with the Climate Exchange Programme, CXC, and so a lot of work on the peatland emission factors and also woodland stuff has been done by us in collaboration with other institutes. The University of Aberdeen we've been involved in with quite a bit to work on this. And we're also members of the Agriculture and Climate Change Stakeholder Group as well. So there's been a number of things that we've had inputs into the plan through. Okay. Sorry, if I can just add also, my title has actually changed from the 1st of January, and it's now just Natural Assets, a theme leader. So it makes it a bit
Gosh,
easier.
Professor, thank you. I wish you'd told me that before, because it was quite a sentence to read out. Yeah. Thank you. And I apologise for using the wrong title. Who'd like to go next? Stuart.
I mean, I can say very briefly that we have quite a lot of contact with the Scottish Government around the whole issue of planting, which is the focal point of where the forestry sector can make a contribution. We also deal with the Forestry Commission on a quite regular basis on some of the other issues, which are maybe less highlighted within the sector as opportunities to contribute. So there's the construction element as well, using wood, especially Scottish wood, in construction. There being a difference between using imported wood and domestic wood. Harvested wood products from domestic wood can be counted, as I understand it, in government's reporting on mitigating or efforts to reduce emissions, whereas imported wood doesn't have the same status. I'd also flag up that just the whole issue of how we manage our woodlands and whether we stock them is an important element of this well, and it's maybe something that hasn't been considered enough so far in this report.
George.
Just on the engagement issue, I think engagement has been good, and it's worth pointing out that there's quite a long backward track in terms of engagement with the forestry sector and the issues over woodland expansion. The Woodland Expansion Advisory Group, for example, did a lot of work on this that I think the RPP2 actually builds on.
As you indicated you wanted to come in.
Yeah, no, I think it's fair to say that this isn't a new element within climate change tackling. You can see a thread between RPP 1, 2, 3. So we have been engaged within the process, talking to both the Scottish Government and the Forestry Commission at every section. And I think we see within this report the culmination of a lot of discussions we've been having.
Alan, do you want to say anything on the process?
Yes, I think for us, this is quite new to us, the RPP process specifically. We received an email a few weeks ago, basically, asking if we would like to put something together and give evidence. But what I did notice and was very encouraged by was that the integration between this process and the land use strategy and such like, I think it is very important that those do tie together and that there's a consensus built around this sort of thing, because one of the commonest reasons I hear from farmers for not wanting to go into forestry or regretting going into forestry is that it's a very long-term business. And whereas if you plant a field of barley, you can change next year if the subsidies change. In forestry, there's always a bit of a reserve about that because you're making a commitment for a very long time. So I think there needs to be an equally long-term commitment and vision from the political side. And I think that this is an important part of that. So we're very glad to be along.
Okay, well, thank you for that. John, I think you're going to ask the next question.
Thanks, Convener. And I think two parts to my question. First of all, I mean, RPP2 has already been mentioned, and the reality is we've not been planting as much as we had hoped, and the committee has actually looked at this, but we want to put some more stuff on the record today. So, I mean, if we haven't reached the 10,000 per year so far, is it realistic to think we can increase that in the future, or is that just over-optimistic? And then secondly, on the use of wood products, you know, again, is it realistic that we could use more wood in construction and so on? Or is that, again, over-optimistic?
Stuart, because he's given evidence before, it knows the seam. If you wave your hand first at the beginning of the question, I will try and bring the first person in. So don't be intimidated by Stuart. But Stuart, if you'd like to start.
I think it's just my natural enthusiasm, Convener. I mean, I think it is achievable. The targets are achievable. We haven't achieved them in the past, and we provide some information on why this is the case. But to recap from our perspective, what we've seen is that it's been supported through grants and through an agricultural system, a system designed for farming, not designed to support forestry. And that means it's not necessarily fit for purpose. It creates problems. We have it then tied into cap cycles. And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to look at history and see that as you come up to a new cap period and then come out of that, there's a falling away of planting. As you move from one scheme to another, and as farmers put their, you know, to some extent, because a lot of this happens on farming land, sit in their hands. And the other part of it is the scheme process, where if you've got a large planting scheme, then it can take many years to get it approved and cost an awful lot of money. And can we then change these? I mean, absolutely. Assuming we leave the Common Agricultural Policy, then we've got an opportunity to design these systems to suit ourselves. Equally, whichever route we go down, we've got to get a balance between having an integrated rural policy, but provide planting grants for trees, which isn't tied into an integrated system designed for agriculture in the way that we have. And if we look across the Irish Sea to the Republic, that's the route they've gone down. It's something we had suggested 4 or 5 years ago and told wasn't possible, but clearly it is. So I think there are actions that we can take alongside improving the scheme with the output from James McKinnon's report for Fergus Ewing, which was published recently. We can achieve that. We think those things were in place, we would have been hitting that 10,000 hectare a year target, because there is land out there and there's interest out there.
George.
I think it's important that we recognise that forestry is a long-term business, and SRDP, the first version of SRDP, was actually disastrous for woodland creation, particularly in the early years. There's been a lot of changes since then, and the scheme is now much more fit for purpose, but we lost a huge amount of momentum at that stage, which we now can see returning because of the changes that have been made, and as Stuart's mentioned, the implementation of the recommendations that McKinnon has made is going to be really important. It's a bit disappointing that it's taken a bit of an outsider to come in and knock heads together and effectively state the bleeding obvious in terms of some of the issues that we've had in terms of the whole process for approval, which have become burdensome, inefficient, and adding little value to the process despite its cost.
Charles, would you like to come in on that?
Well, I'd echo the points made about the process by which funding is arrived at, but I would also point to land supply and the way in which the land use strategy is implemented in terms of identifying land that can be used for afforestation. I know we've had two very successful pilots of the land use strategy in Scotland, Unfortunately, we seem to have run aground after those pilots because they involve investment. And that's why I'm very pleased to note within these proposals that there is a commitment for the Scottish Government to invest in local planning authorities to assist them with, well, it doesn't use the word invest, it uses the word support. I'm choosing to interpret that as invest, and I will continue to do so until I'm told otherwise, to support local planning authorities in the development of local forestry and woodland strategies, which I would like to see integrated with proper regional land use management and at a strategic level. At the moment, that is not invested in by the Scottish Government. It is left entirely to local planning authorities, who are hard-pressed enough already with the work they have to do without taking on an extra element. So land use strategies came out of the very first Climate Change Act. It's really important that we integrate land use with the climate change outcomes that we want. We have to take land use seriously, and to do that we need to implement regional strategies for land use. So that's what I would look at.
Does anyone else want to come in who hasn't said anything? Alan, yes, of course.
Yeah, I think we'd be slightly less sanguine about whether the targets will be met. I think we're moving in the right direction, and we would also welcome the McKinnon report, which I think sort of nails it really in terms of some of the problems of process that there's been, and we think that will help. But looking at the timescale for achieving the targets, it seems to be assumed that almost immediately we'll leap back up to 10,000. On the basis of the McKinnon report. And I don't think that's really the case. I think it will take a while to implement some of those things. Some of them are quite deep-seated. I don't think in themselves they will achieve the targets. So I think we need to look more broadly. And the big thing that's really left out of the report, as far as we're concerned, is that woodland creation doesn't happen in a vacuum. Stuart mentioned the common agricultural policy. There are competing subsidies. And, sorry? Is
that... yeah. No, keep going, sorry. Right.
There are competing subsidies at work which influence land managers. And that really needs to be addressed, I think, before the targets can be met. And we're living in interesting times at the moment. The only certain thing really about our relationship with Europe and the CAP is uncertainty. So we think now is really the time to be planning for both possible outcomes with that, and for taking advantage of the real opportunities actually that would come if we were out of the CAP, to have a much more integrated policy between agriculture and forestry. I noted something in the NFU's contribution. They rather ruefully noted that if farmers do anything in forestry, if they plant up an area, it's immediately taken out of the agricultural accounting and put into forestry. They felt they couldn't get any credit for that. It's rather the same if a hill sheep farmer wants to plant trees, and the rational thing with a hill sheep farm is to look at how much in-by land you've got, see how much hill land that can support, and really put the rest to trees as an income stream and shelter. At the moment, again, if they do that, they're sort of told, oh, that's not agriculture in the context of the CAP, so it won't be funded like agriculture is. The difference in subsidy is enormous. So that's a real skew there, which we do have an opportunity to end.
Can I just bring Mike in, because there's a bit on products which you haven't mentioned, and I just wondered if anyone wanted to mention that. But maybe Mike's question will tie in, if that's...
Just in the Parliament, in the Chamber,
in the last forestry debate, there was cross-party unanimity, and the minister agreed that he would set up a panel of experts to look at, to advise him on looking at a new system post-2020 about how we got. I just wondered if we're at a stage when any of your organisations have yet been approached to think about advising the government on a new system of subsidies to, because what you're saying is basically this has come out of agriculture, and really we need one, a forestry, one designed for forestry. Any response to that yet?
Could I just say that a brief answer, yes or no, if you've been approached at this stage, would be very helpful. Stuart?
No, we've not been approached, but we're developing our own thinking, which we want to share.
Okay. Professor?
No, we haven't been approached.
Charles?
No, we haven't been approached.
Okay. And Alan, I'm assuming not. John had mentioned the increase of wood products in construction, and is that what you want to come back on, George?
Perfect. I realise that we'd not actually answer that question, or that part of your question. Certainly speaking for the sawmilling capacity, the substantial green mill capacity in Scotland that could increase. Timber is an internationally traded commodity, and at the moment Scottish mills are running rather slower than we would like to see, really as a consequence of the world economy, and it's a demand issue really rather than a supply issue. So there is capacity, certainly in the sawn capacity.
Is the demand issue if people are not wanting to use wood or not wanting to use Scottish wood?
It is not a Scottish wood issue. It's a worldwide wood issue based on the world economy being rather sluggish, and therefore there is a surplus supplies on the world market, which affects our import competition.
Do you want to come back on that?
Obvious issues and short-term issues of supply and demand, but I think the main thing is could we use more wood? Because if we're going to increase and meet these targets, then we have to be using more wood in construction. And in our perspective is there's a lot of opportunity to use more timber in not just in housing, but in construction generally. At the moment, I think we're about 70% wood for new build through timber frames, which means there's still 30% of housing which is not built with wood. We are developing products with wood, like cross-laminated timber, glue lam, which allows us to put wood into bigger sections, to go into high-rise buildings, into office blocks and the like. So there's a lot of innovation, there's a lot of development, and there's still a lot of opportunity out there. I think what we're facing is there's still a lack of, perhaps, understanding of how wood is a suitable product, and in some cases, over-specification. So Scottish wood may be graded, not to get into too much technical detail, at a lower grade than imported wood because, in summary, it's faster growing. But we can often use that Scottish wood in places where people are specifying a higher grade unnecessarily, and that's educating architects. So I think there is a number of elements we need to look at here in order to hit the target. It hasn't really been explored within the RPP3 paper, but it is definitely achievable.
So that would be good and worthwhile doing. Rhoda, I think you're on to the next question.
Yes, and it's just on that issue. obviously, the faster growing woods are the ones that people are saying are lower grades, but there are uses for that. But how do we, I suppose, get our own hardwoods involved in construction and the like? And I know historically hardwood you wouldn't call them plantation, but they've never been managed properly. Can we manage native hardwoods better to provide the grades required, as well as kind of educate architects to use lower grades and indeed wood products that can be used very well in construction?
An opportunity to use both more hardwoods and softwoods. We focus on softwoods because, to be blunt, the vast majority of wood that's consumed, including housing, is made from softwood, and that's globally what's traded and what's used in the UK. But there are opportunities to use more hardwoods if we can. The slower growing, and they tend to be more expensive per unit of production, which then obviously has an impact on how you can utilise them. I think part of the issue we have is that we've lost that culture of managing woodlands generally to produce products, and a lot of the establishment of woodland that we've had in recent decades has been about it's good for wildlife, but not necessarily then working with the person who's planting those woods to say, well, why don't you manage them so you can then have a high quality tree at the end of the day, which can then provide income and support local activity. So we, unfortunately, the resource that we have tends to be not very good for high value uses such as construction, and therefore it's still a bit of a niche market. But if we look at this going forward and say, how do we make sure that when we are working with grants, with supporting woodland management, that we're encouraging people who own hardwood or broadleaf trees to manage them, then it's something that we can change for the future. Unfortunately, the cycles are probably 50 to 60 years to 70 years from now, rather than the 20 to 30 years that we're looking at for, you know, for softwoods which have been planted in the past.
A lot of planting occurs, I mean, people follow the money, be it a tax break, which you're not really fussy what you're planting as long as you're ticking that box to get to qualify for the tax break. Also, if you are getting the same amount of grant for a fast-growing softwood as a slower-growing hardwood, surely is the way we look at financing and encouraging forestry needing a total overhaul to make sure we get it right, to get the right product?
Stuart, before you answer that, because I know you want to answer all the questions with your enthusiasm, which I noticed. Charles is quite keen to come in, and I'd quite like to see if I could bring him on, partly on what was answered before, and see if you'd like to answer on that as well.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Stuart's right that ultimately it will be the subsidy regime and the grants that are available that will drive this. But we have lost a lot of the culture of hardwood management within Scotland. But that's where it's actually a great advert for the Forestry Commission in Scotland, who, particularly in the southwest, are able to do a lot of experimenting with trying to bring back productive hardwood skills and productive hardwood management, and trying to regrow that culture within Scotland. The profit is further down the line, but there could be value in that. We heard before in agriculture that sometimes maybe we should focus on a better end product rather than chasing efficiencies in the system. Maybe the same is true of forestry. Those skills are not spread across Scotland, but they are there being tested in part thanks to the Forestry Commission.
George, you want to come in as well?
Well, first of all, just to comment or add to that, I think I think there's a bit of an impression that Charles has given there that may not be, I don't believe is correct. The majority of the existing hardwood resources in the private sector, not on the public forest estate, by a long way. There always has been a differential in terms of grant rates, because it is more expensive to plant broadleaves than it is to plant conifers and to get them successfully established. Past grant incentives for broadleaves has essentially been targeted at just planting those trees, just planting those species, without much thought as to what the end point would be, and therefore the way the schemes have worked has encouraged planting trees, broadleaf trees at wide spacing, which actually vastly reduces the potential for utilizable material coming out of those. So there's a number of lessons that we know and we recognize. The new grant scheme is today is much better balanced than the old SRDP, and there is more focus on productive broadleaves, which was almost absent in the past. It was simply a case of planting hectares with trees widely spaced, which didn't give much opportunity at all for wood production. I'd also like to add, I think the issue about the culture, we can address that very rapidly. We've got a very expert, professional bunch of forest managers in Scotland that will respond to the opportunities. And although the culture has largely been lost, I think it can be reinstilled quite quickly.
Stuart, now's your chance to come in.
Thank you, Convener. I'll just one specific point, and to respond to Rhoda's question about whether the grant system or the mechanisms that we have to support are appropriate or that we should change them. I mean, essentially, to achieve planting, we're providing a grant to pay for the capital cost of planting the trees, and then you're effectively providing financial support to help compensate the farmer for losing the CAP payments that, that they're giving up by planting trees. So moving forward, I think we're never going to get away from the need for a capital payment, especially if you're looking at broadleaf trees because of the costs. But there is an opportunity to look at a post-CAP system of supporting farmers and wider people working in the rural economy to ensure that we don't have these break-off points between somebody switching from agriculture to forestry activity.
Red, did you want to follow?
I suppose that then takes us to the age-old question that you're skewering money for agriculture into forestry, and there is a fear that you do that, you get everyone running in that direction because it's obviously not so labour-intensive once you've got your trees planted. And there would then be a concern from food producers that food production would fall. So it's not maybe quite as straightforward as you're suggesting.
Well, two quick things. I'm sure Alan could come in on this one as well. I mean, one is that if a farmer is planting some of the Lambert trees, then they're still receiving the income. So it's not in the same way, and we're looking at the CO2 issue, and farmers saying, well, look, you know, if we plant trees, it's been benefiting the forestry sector and recorded there rather than agriculture sector. If the finance is being paid to achieve an outcome, then it's the landowner, the farmer, who receives the benefit. I also think that also, you know, flags up the issue of how we deliver a lot of the tree planting we're seeking. There's big opportunities for sheep farmers in particular to be planting trees on part of the land, and in doing so, having minimal impact on their production. Planting trees in broader shelter belts is a decent-sized woodland, but it also provides shelter for sheep, which means that they then require less feed. So there are ways in which we can integrate these, I think, that would encourage farmers to see this as an opportunity and not as a zero-sum loss from farming to forestry.
Alan, do you want to come in on that?
I don't think I need to. I would have said that.
Ray, did you want to ask? If I could move on slightly, but sort of on the same topic. We've seen new targets announced by the government, and my question is that are the timescales appropriate? Are we being ambitious enough? And do you think there's sufficient funds being put into it? Those of you that saw the debate will have seen that I passed comment on that, but I'd be welcome to have your comment on it. And perhaps we could just start at that end and just work down, if that would be all right. George?
I think the issue of funding is a chicken and an egg or a horse and cart issue in terms of we've failed to meet targets and therefore we've not actually bumped up against the funding ceilings. My impression is that there is a commitment from Scottish Government to really back these targets, and the money will be found. And certainly we've not had an issue so far that as planting or demand for planting has increased and it is increasing, and there is actually quite a good pipeline at the moment for the 10,000 hectare target, that those funds will in fact be made available. So I think, or I hope, that and the sense I have and others have in the industry is there's great support from Scottish Government to actually financially back achievement of those targets, even though in any one year it may appear that we're planning to fail. I think the targets are about right. I think they are stretch targets, but they're not overly ambitious, and provided there's adequate commitment across the board to achieving these, then I think they can be delivered.
Hey, George, can I just push you just a wee bit on that? Is that some people who might be considering planting trees might be put off by the fact that they don't see the grant in the pipeline although there may be nice words from the government. The whole issue of the costs of developing the woodlands and the fact that they aren't seeing the grant available, do you think that's affecting them?
I don't think it is, because there's a barrier ahead of that, which is hopefully going to be addressed with the McKinnon report, and it's the process. So unless you're planting a very small scheme, the burden of the application process is a major disincentive. Now, we know what we need to do to change that, and would-be planters are looking to see how people will behave. So we've heard the words, and we're looking for the behaviour. So early signals from how McKinnon's recommendations are going to be implemented, I think, are really important to make sure we get the momentum we need.
Okay, thank you. Charles?
Well, I'll stick my neck out and say that I think we will reach the 10,000 hectare target this year. That's not necessarily as a result of the McKinnon recommendations starting to feed through, but rather as a result of the fact that we only planted 4,700 hectares last year as a result of the SRDP changeover. So there was some pent-up demand sitting there in the pipeline that will be manifest this year. In terms of the wider issue, timescales for planting, they say the best time to plant a tree is 50 years ago, and the next best time is today. So the timescales within this report are achievable. Some would argue that they need to be more ambitious. Certainly continuing with the 10,000 hectare target for the next 10 years, until 2024, is not going to do anything to address the backlog of failures to meet that 10,000 hectare target over the last few years. So there would definitely be scope for delivering a bit more faster. However, that then takes us to the second question, which is that funding. And you'll see in Confor's submission that they've calculated that to deliver what's in here, you would require £45 million for forestry funding, whereas it's the current draft budget only raises the forestry grants to £40 million. I would add to that that even that, if that pot was devoted entirely to new woodland creation, the rest of that pot is also depended on for maintenance and management and tree health issues and deer management and so many other issues that, again, like the funding for local authorities to work on land use strategies, unless this is supported, the whole process is supported. The political will is all very well, but it's got to be backed up with cold hard cash.
Okay, so the Cabinet Secretary is running around for another £5 million as you speak. Professor?
Yes, I don't think I've got much to add to what's already been said on this one, but I think the targets probably are achievable with the provisos regarding funding and so on. But the only other thing I perhaps would add on top of that is that really we need to think about the targets of CO2 reduction or greenhouse gas reduction, and not only the areas involved. The targets as given in the climate change plan are purely area-based, and I think it even seems to be a move away from the amount of CO2 that's actually saving. It's, that, after all, is the target we're hoping to get. And work that we've done at the James Hutton Institute has really shown that it depends where the trees go, I think, and that's a real important question as to what sort of savings are actually made. And so you can be very successful in achieving a certain planting area target, but not necessarily a CO2 reduction target. So I think that's an important thing to consider as well. And certainly with the current climate change plan, there's no evidence, or at least no target at all presented, as far as I can see, in terms of the actual emission reduction targets. Okay, it's perhaps an omission.
Thank you.
I would agree. I think the timescales are appropriate. I'm always happier to see them brought forward, but I think it's achievable. In terms of the funding, I would, or the funds required, I highlight the point I made earlier that if you plant trees on farmland, you're not stealing from farmers to give to foresters. You're recycling the pot within the farming community. So we should look at how we fund forestry planting as not being a silo activity. I think in terms of the cost that's involved, the average cost of the planting that we've had over the last 5 years has been higher than we would expect going forward, for the reason that it's been a higher proportion of broadleaf trees compared to softwood trees, and that's not been in the proportions that the government had sought or the private sector had sought. But going forward, we're seeing a higher proportion of softwood trees being in the applications that are there, and therefore they're cheaper to plant, so that should bring the average cost down. But at the end of the day, we will still need to have some additional funds to achieve the targets that we're setting ourselves. And I would also make a plea in that context that we are seeing a lot of interest coming forward. I think ahead of us leaving the Common Agriculture Policy, if that's what eventually transpires, it might encourage a lot of landowners to come forward and say, I'd like to plant now on the basis of what I understand is available to me. And therefore, there's a danger that we could be turning people away over the next year or two. So I'd caution that we would keep that envelope, if I can put it that way, open.
Okay, interesting point. Alan.
Okay, well, without repeating what's already been said, just a couple of points. One is that with the grant rates, that we should really avoid trying to have a bidding war between different land uses. We can end up sort of ratcheting up because we're not achieving one target and then another. If you do that, what you end up is simply subsidizing land ownership, because that gets factored into land prices, that gets factored into land rents, and so forth. And so the money is going pretty much directly to the landowners without achieving any change in land use. So again, we can't ask about forestry grants in isolation from the other grants on the land. One point on targets to add to what's already been said. We're restructuring a lot of forests now that were planted around about the 70s or so. And this is a very good thing, because it allows us to achieve a much greater range of benefits, many more public benefits, exploiting a lot of synergies. But it does mean that we are getting less timber production from those forests going forwards. And if we don't want to end up simply displacing timber demand overseas, then we do actually have to be quite ambitious about the targets here. And looking at the target of 21% by the end of this process, I would just note that is still very low by European standards.
Thank you. If we may, I'm going to move on to the next question, which in this case will be Jamie, please.
Thank you, convener. And thank you all for those excellent contributions. There's lots coming out, and unfortunately time is short. I'd like to talk, bringing it back to the climate change plan itself. It states in the plan that the woodland creation ambition will directly benefit all those that work in forestry, farmers, crofters, and land managers who create woodland. But at the same time, it also says that woodland creation can have significant positive or negative impacts on the landscape. I wonder if you had any views or comments on the plan itself, or if you agree to an extent or disagree with that statement.
Who'd like to go first? Alan. Good.
I would agree with that statement. It's entirely true. What it maybe doesn't do is flesh out what makes that difference. And I think it's basically good forest design is what makes the difference. So it's good that support for UK forestry standards and so on is in the plan as well. This is really where those synergies I was talking about come in. It's, if you have good forest design, it's not a zero-sum game between carbon storage, livestock shelter, water retention, economic production, and so on. But if you have bad forest design, it can be.
Yes.
To that point, in your submission, you make the comment that land suitable for afforestation in Scotland for timber production and native woodland is currently subsidised for other uses. So I think you make a point about good forestry creation, but there is a fundamental issue here in that the land has already been used most likely for sheep farming or other uses. So there is a sort of trees not sheep sort of message in your input to the plan. So I just wonder if you could develop that a little bit further.
Well, I think the good design message really applies not just, you shouldn't see farming and forestry as silos, each having their own good design. There really needs to be good design in the integration of them as well. And with the sheep, I mentioned that sheep are still productive and profitable in some areas. If you have improved in by land, then that can support a population of sheep, which then can make use of an area of hill. But what we have at the moment is that the areas of hill on those farms are vastly larger than the in-by can really support. So sheep are being ranged very extensively. What happens when you do that is that they're preferential brezers, so they'll breze out the bits they like best. You'll get a mat of purple moorgrass and such building up. That stops nutrient return to the soil. So it's actually a situation which is really quite poor for farming. For the farmers themselves would be a lot better off if they were more able to put more of their land to forestry, integrated in a whole system.
Thank you.
George, you sort of indicated that...
To try and answer the two parts of your question, the direct benefit to those in the industry and the downstream side clearly will benefit. It's important to recognise how big an industry that's become now, and the forest industry in its entirety is now a bigger industry, contributing more to the Scottish economy than fishing, for example, and it has considerable scope to grow. I think the impact on the landscape, I think good design is a given now. The process we have to go through means that the forests created today are radically different to the ones that I cut my teeth on when I started in the industry, which were much more utilitarian. And it's really, I think, we come down to a bit of an issue of taste in terms of the impact on the landscape and a general human resistance to the process of change. And there's lots of documented cases of objections to forests and woodlands being created, and then objections when somebody and generations later have come to try and remove those. I think it's all about a sensitive process, but one that that can move along at a sensible pace, which is where I come back to McKinnon, that we need to make sure that the design and the whole approval process is something that's actually fit for purpose and uses the resources wisely. The cost involved for a large scheme now, to the applicant, it can be £100,000. That's a lot of money. So for a scheme of 100 hectares, and there's not much difference in terms of scale when you get up to that stage, you know, that's £1,000 a hectare of cost that's going in there that, in my view, is very poor value. It doesn't help the decision-making. And that's because the scoping exercise is far too wide. And as McKinnon has said, let's focus on what's important. Don't waste time proving what we already know. Let's make sure that for the environmental assessment or something similar to that, if it's not actually requiring an EIA, focuses on the issues that really are material to making the decision. If we can nail that, that will make a huge difference, both in terms of the attitude of people wanting to create woodland and to actual delivery.
Another person in at this stage, Charles, Professor, do you want to come in or I know Stuart will always come in if it,
very brief point to make, and it returns to the previous one I made in terms of the effect on the landscape. I think we can't forget about the soil underneath, and certainly when we're planting trees, there's a lot of disturbance which results in CO2 emissions because of that disturbance. So, it takes something in the order of about 10, 15 years before the balance is actually restored again in terms of the carbon stored by the trees. So. And that depends very much on the type of soil that the trees are actually being planted on. So the study that my colleagues have done at JHI, they've quantified this and done it spatially across the whole of Scotland and shown the areas where there is a positive benefit from planting trees, because in quite large areas, and not just on the deep peats, which are excluded at the moment, there is a negative balance for quite a period of time. So they have pluses and minuses, I guess. It's very important where you actually place the trees on the landscape in terms of the carbon balance.
Okay, thank you very much. The final question is going to come from the Deputy Convener. Before I ask her to ask it, you are all going to get a chance to answer this. So just to give you a chance to think about your answers while the question is being asked.
Thank you, Convener. Again, as I asked the agricultural sector, we've heard a lot, and thank you, your contributions have been extremely valuable. We've talked about subsidies, attitude, land use, funding. I think we've gone over quite a broad range of issues. Are there any policies or proposals that have not been included that you would have liked to have seen in the plan?
George, you can start.
There's almost no reference to our existing woodlands and making sure that they contribute as best they can to climate change. There's two issues there for me. One is the process of restocking. The longer the rotation, then and the interval between felling the trees and replanting is a critical part in terms of just carbon capture, contribution to the economy, the wood production, and so on. There's two broad schools of thought, largely practiced in the private sector, and certainly by my company, what we now call hot planting. So we like to restock as quickly as we possibly can, within weeks almost, of if the season's right, behind the harvester. Whereas, for reasons that I still don't fully understand, and I should declare that I'm a forestry commissioner, the Forestry Commission choose to delay restocking largely as a response to weevil. And it seems to me very odd that there's two main schools of thought there, and I harbour a suspicion that funding and matching budgets has been a major driver towards that delay. So I think I would like to see more focus about how we continue to manage the existing woodlands to maximise our contribution to carbon capture and climate change, and particular focus on restocking. And let me not forget the loss of forestry from our existing planting. And I grieve over the areas of forest that have been lost to wind farms. It seems to me striking that the hill that had the trees on it is the one with the wind farms on it, and the one next door without trees on it, somehow or other, has been left without development. So we've got a net issue here in terms of area. Must not forget the loss as well as the gain from woodland creation.
Okay. Thank you. Charles?
I'm going to be very similar, I'm afraid. I think when the Committee on Climate Change investigated how Scotland was doing with its climate change plan, when they looked at forestry, they looked a lot at the existing forestry and the risk from tree disease and tree pests. As part of that, they said that there was a risk of Scotland's existing woodland sequestering less carbon because of the lower proportion of young trees within it, which again brings us back into the issue of deer management, which I'm sure all MSPs are very familiar with. Our existing woodlands need to be better looked after. The Native Woodland Survey of Scotland from 2014 revealed that more than 50% of Scotland's native woods were in an unfavourable condition, and a large part that was down to failed regeneration and invasive non-native species within it. So it's great that we have this ambition to create more woodland, more and more woodland, but it's like turning on the tap while you've still got the plug out. We need to put the plug in and start looking after the water that's in the bath, no, the trees that we already have. So we need to be good stewards of the trees we already have so that we will be better stewards of the trees that we are going to grow over the next 20 years.
Thank you. Professor?
I suppose the only thing, in addition, that I would like to have seen more of is something on agroforestry. I think when I searched through, there was only one mention of it, and that was right at the end anyway. I mean, we've talked about it a little bit already, and I think there's a lot of scope for trying to explore this, you know, interface between agriculture and forestry. We tend to see them as two different silos, I think, of, often. So if there was more on you know, trying to encourage agroforestry, and I'm drawing a distinction, I suppose, between farm woodlots and my concept of agroforestry, which is more growing trees and crops together and looking for the synergies between them. So I guess I'd like to see more on that.
Stuart.
I very strongly support the point about looking at existing forests and understanding what's happening in there and dealing with losses. I think what we need to do is make sure that we're monitoring every year changes in forest cover to be able to understand if we're not replanting, why that is not happening, and tackling it. And we are worried that there seems to be an increasing bank of land which once had trees, which was expected to again have trees and doesn't have trees, and we haven't really got to the bottom of that, so I'd flag that up as a key point. The other thing I do think is actually missing is that the linkages between forestry and other sectors, it's often forestry has been looked at as a silo, but as we've already discussed, you plant trees in agricultural land and you're benefiting the agricultural side of the activity there. And there are only three, well, there are three big areas which sit above the line in terms of emissions when we're looking at the graphs of emissions: agriculture, transport, and industry. Agriculture, forestry can contribute. Industry, we have a large manufacturing industry based around using wood. And quite simply, it has a positive carbon balance. So we're locking up wood in those wood products, and the process of producing those wood products releases a lot less energy than steel, concrete, plastic, brick. So by having more forestry manufacturing activity, we can have a successful industry but actually be reducing our carbon emissions. So I think those linkages across forestry to these other elements is perhaps missing in RPP 3 and hopefully can be addressed in the future.
Alan.
Well, I wrote down a list of points when you asked your question, and I've crossed them all out by now. So essentially, I would just support that I think the problem with the report as it stands is it has a very narrow focus on planned woodland creation and tree planting and so on. And it does miss out the very variable nature of existing woods and the need to look after them, and also the fact that a lot of woodlands come to be by natural regeneration. You know, across most of Europe, there is natural regeneration. When people, you know, when you stop doing almost anything else with land, it goes to forest. That often doesn't happen in Scotland to a large extent because of deer numbers. So we need to look at those factors as well beyond the forest fence.
Thank you very much. I think that the last points that you brought up were particularly interesting. Hot planting is something I've not heard of before, and I think that the whole issue of managing existing woodlands that we have is critical, and I think the committee will want to look at that more carefully, as they will want to look at agricultural forestry connections between the two and the whole issue of forestry cover and making sure that we're not losing the existing trees that we've got. But it's been very helpful for us. Thank you very much for coming in and giving of your time. I would remind you, if there's something that you feel that we haven't explored enough and you want to get back to us on, you've got till the 10th of February to do so. So thank you very much, and I'd like to now very briefly suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to move. Thank you. Agenda item 4 now. The committee is invited to consider a legislative consent memorandum lodged by the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and Connectivity, outlined in Paper 5. The legislative consent motion relates to the UK Digital Economy Bill. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have considered the LCM on Tuesday, the 31st of January, and have made a number of recommendations it wished to make to the committee. As you will be aware, it raised serious concerns regarding the breadth of data sharing provided to the Scottish ministers by the LCM. These echo the concerns that were raised in the equivalent House of Lords Committee. Members will note that the timetable that we've been given for the LCM is extremely tight, and I think we can probably all agree that that situation is not ideal. The members will note that the DPLR committee is content with the aspects of the LCM that refers to MAS and the communication code, which specifically relates to ARMIT. The DPLR's committee's concerns relate to data sharing aspects of the LCM. These provisions are so broadly ranging that a significant number of committees would also have would be engaged under their remit. None of them have had the opportunity to scrutinise the LCM due to the tight timescale. As the lead committee, we are required to reflect upon the memorandum and then consider whether we are content with the terms. We will then report our findings to the Parliament. Do any committee members have any comments on it? Stuart.
Thank you very much, Convener. And, I've been a member of the DPLR on a couple of occasions. Spent quite a lot of time in the trenches on this subject. I'm not sure I would give the same weight that the DPLR has chosen to the issue of the powers that are being given to ministers, which is essentially a power to change the list of bodies that are affected. And that's a kind of pretty standard thing that ministers do. Because in the Scottish arrangements in this Parliament, the secondary legislation that is under discussion with the DPLR is a matter for Parliament. Yes, ministers are the ones who lay it, but that does not deprive the Parliament of the opportunity in a negative instrument to intervene to stop it, and requires, in the case of an affirmative instrument, that Parliament takes a decision on the matter. I'm not 100% clear of the processes that take place at Westminster, but I understand there's a less clear way for these similar things that happen there to be dealt with the Parliament there. So I think what I say doesn't invalidate what I believe the House of Lords is saying in similar terms about this legislation. For my part, I'm quite neutral as to what we as a committee do, but I don't find myself overly concerned by some of the observations that DPLR has chosen to put to us.
Mike, can I bring
I am
you?
Very concerned by the observations of the DPLR committee. I mean, just read one to put it on the record. It says that it quotes the House of Lords saying that we are deeply concerned about the power to prescribe a specified person providing services to a public authority. We recommend that the clause should be removed from the bill, and the committee agrees, and the DPLR says the committee agrees with those recommendations of the Delegated Powers and Regulatory Reform Committee in their application. And it goes on, which I won't go into to quote these, but I'm certainly not going to, I don't support this. And I don't want to, I actually think this is so important, I'm going to raise this issue at the Bureau on Tuesday, because I'd like to see a debate on the floor of the Chamber about this. So I think a way forward for the committee is not to have a debate now and here in the committee, but on this, but I think to note this and let members in the chamber have a wider debate about this so we can make some sort of decision.
Okay, just before I bring in John on this, because he's indicated that he wants, and I'd just like to remind the committee that we do actually have three options open to us. We can either approve it, we can disapprove it, or we can note it. And by noting it, we would send it back to the government, and it would then be up to them to decide whether they wanted to debate it further. So those are the three areas that I see we have. John, you wanted to come in, sorry.
Yes, I think it would just be to say that, I mean, in many cases, you know, the buck stops with us as a committee on a whole range of issues, and if we don't do something about it, nobody else will. I think in this case, the buck stops with the House of Lords committee, which has raised these concerns. I broadly agree with these concerns, but I think the reassuring thing for our committee is that it is being dealt with where the bill is, i.e. at Westminster. And so I think I'm quite relaxed about our reaction to this, whether we note it or support it or whatever, on the, because the House of Lords are actually dealing with these very points that we are concerned about.
Okay, thank you, John. Does anyone else?
I very much agree with Mike's summation of the thing. I think he's absolutely right. I think the data protection thing is such a wide-ranging issue, and I think we've all said that timescale's very short, and I just feel we should note this, but this bit of legislation and refer it to, it should be debated in the chamber, I believe.
Can I suggest then, I mean, we could take other opinions, but there seems to be a sort of opinion that noting maybe the LCM would be the way forward. Can I therefore make a recommendation to the committee that we note the LCM and pass it back as that? Would that meet everyone's approval? Okay, and of course we will produce a small report which reflects the decision of the committee.
Point of clarification: if we note it, does that mean that it will be debated, as Mike has suggested, part of the report suggest?
Well, I think it's up to the government to bring forward a motion, and I think that will be down to the Bureau and the government to decide, and I think we've had an indication from Mike that matter will be raised at the Bureau. So can I please therefore have your approval to say that we are noting the LCM? Okay, thank you. That's agreed. I'd now like to suspend the meeting to allow the committee to move forward into private session for the last item. Thank you.